presentation of ABC Sports. We are on the banks of the Red Cedar River in East Lansing, Michigan, where today ABC Sports College Football presents an interconference clash between the Huskers of Nebraska and the Spartans of Michigan State. It is a beautiful day, folks, for a college football game on campus. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Mark Jones in the house, and welcome to the most important day in Michigan State football since their Rose Bowl game back in 1988. Why? Well, today marks the beginning of the Nick Saban era. He's the new head coach here with new energy and new intensity. Unfortunately for Saban's crew, today they take on the Rolls Royce of college football programs, the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
There can be no great victories without tremendous adversity. So it's a tremendous challenge to us. If we could win this game, it would give us and our program a lot of national prestige. But it's one game in an 11-game season and the first game of a new program.
It's going to be a tough ball game, I think. I think it'll go right into the fourth quarter. I think it'll be really a real head knocker. I'm sure they'll throw the ball a lot, and we'll get a good test of our secondary, our pass rush.
This game has been highly anticipated and debated for a long time in these parts. And you know what? Dean Blevins is caught up in the festivities. Dean, what's up?
John Madden! Thank you, Mark. One of the great game day traditions here at Michigan State. The band comes marching in, thousands lining the street. Band director John Madden.
How are you?
Hey, you sound ready today.
We're feeling great. This weather is terrific. The band is pumped. That's a beautiful scene in college football right there. We couldn't be more excited.
He's exactly right. Back to the booth, guys.
All right, Dean, grab yourself a tuba, a trombone, or whatever, maybe a little suntan lotion, too. Perfect weather, folks. We'll be back for the opening kickoff. It's the Cornhuskers and the Spartans.
They also
next.
Have to put pressure on Banks. He's a...
We are back at Spartan Stadium in East Lansing, Michigan for this, the third meeting between the Cornhuskers and the Michigan State Spartans. And Todd Blackledge, hey, Nebraska comes in here overwhelming favorites. When you look at the skill positions, you understand why, too.
Well, Mark, any defensive coordinator that's preparing to face this Husker offense has to know he's ready for a double Heisman headache. First, there's I-back Lawrence Phillips, Mr. Consistency, over 1,700 yards last year. In the opener against Oklahoma State, 153 yards. The thing about him, he's strong and tough. He can get you the tough yards, but watch his ability to make people miss, break a few tackles, and a couple broken tackles later, Phillips is off to the end zone. Then there's quarterback Tommy Frazier. He's been a starter ever since he stepped foot on campus as a freshman. He missed 7 games last year because of the blood clot problem in his leg, but he's battled back to resume the starting role. And Frazier has improved as a passer, but where he really can hurt you is running the option. When he gets out on the perimeter of the defense, he also has the ability to make people miss and break arm tackles. Mark, a premium will be placed on tackling for this Spartan defense today.
Now, Frazier's counterpart, a guy they call Baby Randall, is in Cunningham, Tony Banks.
Well, Tony Banks is an interesting story. A junior college transfer last year from Mesa JC in San Diego. When the season started, he was a great athlete with a strong arm. By the time the season ended, he had matured and developed into a very productive Big Ten quarterback. He has to have a great game today.
Banks says there is absolutely nothing that the Nebraska defense can throw at him that he hasn't seen already. Throw another sausage on the grill, folks. We're going to be serving up some football right after this. Well, Todd, let's take a look at some of the key components to today's game.
Well, Mark, first of all, for Nebraska, you've got to protect the football. Anytime you're an option team, you run the threat of dropping the ball on the ground. Secondly, they've got to put pressure on Tony Banks. He's a good thrower, but he also has the ability to get out of the pocket. For Michigan State, they don't need a good game out of Tony Banks. They need a great game. He has to have the best game of his career. They must play well on first down. They've got to mix up the run and pass on first down and be productive. Thirdly, they have to limit Nebraska's big plays, plays over 15 yards.
A look at Tom Osborne, the head coach of 23 years at Nebraska. He's won 82% of his games during his tenure. National Coach of the Year in 1994. And a look at the bio and dossier of first-year head coach Nick Saban. Last year, his Cleveland Browns team, his defense, allowed the fewest points in the NFL. He is a defensive genius. Michigan State has won the opening toss and has elected to receive. Derek Mason is back deep. He's number 80 for Michigan State. A sellout crowd on hand here in East Lansing, Michigan. Here's the kick. At the 9-yard line, it's Mason. He's dangerous. He coughs it up. Nebraska has the ball on the 33-yard line. It didn't take long for Michigan State to make a gap, not the way they wanted to begin.
Derek Mason has been an outstanding kickoff returner in his career, but this is the first live kickoff, and you can see he was carrying the ball loosely as he tried to jump over the pile. A helmet came in on the football, and right away, a big play for Nebraska. Take a look from behind the play. You see the ball hanging out in his right arm. As he tried to jump over the pile from behind, he was hit. He wasn't able to secure the football, and a big break for Nebraska.
Todd, Nebraska, as a result, working with a short field, beginning their offense on the 35-yard line. Frazier on the option, the pitch to Phillips, cutting it up. And you can feel that high gear, that high-intensity offense getting on track. The ball down to the 22-yard line. There's a look at the starting quarterback for Nebraska. Tommy Frazier, the guy we talked about in the opening, 21-1 as a regular season starter. That one loss was against Iowa State back in 1992.
Mark, when you're playing Nebraska, the worst thing you want to do is give them the short field. You want to make them have to drive the ball 80-plus yards every time they have it. Make them earn their first downs and their points.
And they did get a first down on that carry by Phillips. This is the fullback this time, Makavica, down to the 20-yard line, a pickup of about two. It'll be second down and eight. A look at the chilly starting lineup. Backs and receivers for the Cornhuskers. Reggie Ball, a dangerous deep threat. Lawrence Phillips, the guy we talked about moments ago. Both starters returning from a year ago.
This is a big series. I know it's the first series of the game for Nick Saban's defense, but a big opportunity to come in a sudden change situation, to come onto the field and make a statement early in this ball game.
Two receivers split to the bottom of your screen. Frazier on the toss to Phillips. He's got a block out there. Phillips near the first down marker at the 11-yard line. Looks like he has the first down. The tackle made by Marvin Wright, the strong safety for the Spartans. And a look at that huge, mobile, agile, and hostile offensive line for the Cornhuskers.
Well, they just reloaded at four positions, but the center, Aaron Graham, Tom Osborne says he may be the best that's ever been at Nebraska, going back to Dave Remington's days. Graham, they are really high on him as their center.
Todd, another first down. It's first down and 10 to go from the 11-yard line for the Cornhuskers on this, their opening drive. After that turnover on the kickoff, they come out and there are two tight end, two wide out. Split. This is their ace formation. Phillips over the left side and down to the 7-yard line. The tackle made by Jabbar Threets, number 94 for the Spartans. Boy, Tom Osborne must be thinking, hey, a great way to start a football game, huh?
Well, they played well last week. They executed well offensively for a first game. Normally you have a few breakdowns in your opening game, but they executed very well. They had two fumbles that were just a result of some careless ball handling, but for the most part, good execution. And so far in game two, flawless execution running the option.
Full house backfield. Johnson now in motion. Frazier passing into the end zone. Incomplete for his tight end, Mark Gilman. Todd, it appeared that he actually had two receivers eligible there.
Well, he did have both tight ends crossing the field, one short in the goal line and the other one in the back of the end zone. He also looked like he could have run the ball. Watch as he comes out on the bootleg now. He's coming out. He's got a lead back. The fullback gets a good block for him now. He could have maybe run to the corner. That's a tough throw, trying to throw back across your body. Moving one way, throwing the other way. It's tough to complete.
An important defensive series here, albeit early for the Spartan defense. The two Makavicas in the backfield on third down and seven.
Watch the option from this formation.
Here it comes. Frazier's going to keep it. He doesn't get the first down.
And Mark, that is a huge stop for the Spartan defense. You can see the enthusiasm on the field for the defense. To stop Nebraska in a sudden change situation is outstanding. Reggie Garnett, their middle linebacker, the leader on that defense, came up with the big play.
And in comes Chris Brown now, number 35, to attempt a field goal for Nebraska. Last week he made one from 24 yards out. He was one of one last week. Coming out of the hold of John Vedra. A 22-yard attempt for the freshman. They get it down and it is good. So the Cornhuskers failed to score a touchdown and a reprieve for that Michigan State defense. It's 3-0. We're just underway in East Lansing.
Nebraska's up 3-0. We talked about Michigan State. They had to limit the big plays right there on the game keys. They came away with holding them to a field goal, but you can't drop the ball on the ground and give Nebraska the short field. That was a big play by the Nebraska special team.
And Todd, as you pointed out during the commercial, a big win in some respect for the Michigan State defense, too, to hold them to a field goal.
Sudden change defense is a critical part of any game, coming on the field, making a big stop.
All of Chris Brown's kickoffs went into the end zone last week against Oklahoma State, as does this one. His first one came down at the 9, which Mason fumbled, and Mason does not get a chance at redemption, not this time. Well, the starting quarterback for the Spartans is Tony Banks. He's out of San Diego, California. Last season, he led the Big Ten in passing efficiency, as an excellent arm and good mobility.
You talk to Gary Tranquil, the offensive coordinator who worked for the Browns for several years. He says Banks has all the physical tools. The only question he has, what kind of decision-making will he give us in a big game situation? We'll find out here very soon.
Renaud and Green are the backs behind Banks. First down and 10 from the 18-yard line. Quick three-step drop complete to the far sideline, and a first down to Masin Muhammad, number one, the 6'2", 210 senior. A look now at the Chili starting lineups, the backs and receivers for the Spartans. Mark Renaud, an interesting story, Todd.
Well, Mark Renaud, he's the backup tailback, but the coaches feel he's a little bit bigger, maybe even a little bit faster than Dwayne Goldborn. So they're certainly going to miss Goldborn's productivity out with the broken ankle, but Renaud is no slouch as a backup.
Had an excellent spring and fall. Green in motion to the counter. That's Renaud, and he is drilled, put down at the 35-yard line and put down hard. The tackle that time made by Jason Peter, number 95 for Nebraska. You know, they stressed conditioning and diet, but, you know, they still have a huge offensive line here with the Spartans.
Well, Flazell Adams, he thinks he's streamlined now at 335. He came in last spring at 365, lost 30 pounds, and thinks he's lean and mean now.
Cutting down on those chicken wings at the Landshark. 11:42 remaining in the first quarter, and we have a whistle and flags down.
I think they got Flazell Adams for moving a little bit in his stance.
False start, offense.
Yeah. You know, Nebraska has really great upfield rushers on their defensive end positions. They're not very big, but they're extremely quick, and Flazell Adams that time got caught. Take a look at the Nebraska defensive front. The two Peter brothers on the inside, Christian Peter, he is all man at 6'3", 300 pounds, a senior, the real anchor of this Nebraska defense.
Tomich, a person to watch as well up front. Second down and 12 to go. Spartans with the ball in the 35-yard line. Backs are split behind Banks. Screen pass to Renaud, well set up, and you see the speed right there, and a flag down at the 40, near the 40.
What great poise by Tony Banks, Mark. He knew the blitz was coming, it was unblocked, he knew he was going to get hit, but he held that ball to the last possible moment to set up the screen effectively. Sometimes screen plays work against a blitz, because if you can get a block on the guy that's responsible for the receiver,
personal,
it can be a big play.
Face mask, defense.
Watch, the blitz is going to come from the top left of your screen. Now, Banks is looking right at it, so he knows the blitz is coming. He holds the ball as long as he can and makes the nice soft toss out there to Renaud. Big play for Michigan State.
And the face mask, Todd, moving the ball to Nebraska's side of the field, down to the 47-yard line. Terrell Farley made the tackle on that last play, and he really ran down Renaud. Some of that Nebraska speed defensively.
Shotgun formation here on first down. They're trying to spread out the Nebraska defense. Three wide receivers, only one running back.
Little movement up front. No flags, though. Banks get rid of it quickly. Intended for Muhammad, and another flag down.
Well, now Tony Banks has been hit three times already in this ball game after he releases the football. He got a little bit upset after this one, but they got the penalty called against Nebraska. Now, you know, Nebraska knows that Banks is the key to their offense, so if they're going to throw the ball, they're going to try to put a lick on him every time he throws it. That time, the hit came late, and the official was on the play.
From Jared Tomich, a look at the linebackers for the black shirts. Ellis, a Butkus candidate, and Terwilliger, strong from his position. Another Nebraska penalty.
roughing the passer, defense, first down.
Really uncharacteristic of a Tom Osborne coach team to have two personal fouls. Now watch, Banks is going to get rid of the ball. It's incomplete, and a shot right up to the face gear by Jared Thomas, and that's a good call by the official. It was late to begin with, and it was up around the headgear, and you don't need that.
Banks almost losing his cool going after Thomas and then thinking better of it. Renaud and Green out of the offset eye. The draw play to Renaud. And he fumbles it. Who's got it? The Cornhuskers say they do. And for the second time, the Spartans put the ball on the carpet. Thomas made the recovery. Peter made the hit.
We see Nick Saban there applauding because his offensive team made some plays and they moved the ball. But, you know, this isn't practice anymore. This is live football. You're playing against the number two ranked team in the country. You've got to protect the football. He gets hit again from the side, and that's just a simple matter of not securing the football. Good defensive pressure by Nebraska. Another big break. Michigan State dropping it on the carpet.
The second turnover early in the game by Michigan State. Backs out of the eye. This is Phillips. That's what he can do. Showtime for Lawrence Phillips. And another face mask at the 32-yard line. Phillips finally brought down by Marvin Wright, number 18, and they'll tack a few more yards onto that game. A nice stutter step at the line of scrimmage, Todd.
This play looked exactly like the one we showed in the open, where the play looked like he was kind of hemmed in, was able to make one quick move at the line of scrimmage, bounce it outside for a big play.
Personal foul, face mask, defense.
Take a look again as this play comes at us now. Phillips is going to be stopped right there. He bounces to the outside. The defense of Michigan State committed to the inside run, and once he bounced out, there was no one there but the free safety. Take a look at it again as he bounces to the outside, makes one guy miss, the free safety, Robert Shirelles, and it's a big play. Again, plays over 15 yards. You've got to limit that when you're playing Nebraska. They are a big play team.
That was a heck of a move. Just under 11 minutes to play in the first period. Frazier on the option, going to keep it himself. Frazier down at the 9-yard line. Make that the 8. Brought down by Jabbar Threets. Defensive end, the 6'6", 245-pound junior.
You know, option defense is all about assignments. It's all about knowing who has the fullback, who has the quarterback, who has the pitch man. That time, Michigan State was in good position. Travis Reese, number 41, is going to have the quarterback. Watch the linebacker, Travis Reese, 41. Now, he's going to have the quarterback, but Tommy Frazier is just faster than he thinks, and he outruns him to the corner. Reese was in position. Frazier had too much speed.
Speed does kill, indeed. Second down and 2. They give it to the fullback. Makovica bullying his way down to the 2-yard line. That is just smash mouth football. Garnett finally making the tackle, and it's a first down and goal for Nebraska.
And ran right behind that All-American candidate center, Aaron Graham. Watch the middle of your screen. Aaron Graham just takes the nose guard and pushes him right off the ball. Good block by the right guard, Steve Ott. And when you play Nebraska, you know they're going to give the ball to the fullback a certain number of times to keep him happy and interested in the game.
Frazier gives it to Phillips. Phillips tiptoeing his way into the end zone. Touchdown, Cornhuskers. And folks, if you hear some cheering here, there's about 7,000 folks that made the trip from Lincoln here to East Lansing. I sold about 7,000 tickets, and there is a sea of red in the corner of the end zone.
I don't think they allow you to get on the plane or bus if you don't have all red on either. I mean, that's a statement that they make all across the country.
Chris Brown missed an extra point last week, his first one, but he nails this one. Well, these games are often won in the weight room. It's about strength and speed. 10-0 Cornhuskers. Dean Blevins, tell us about the elements on the field.
Well, Mark, the wind is a little bit more gusty than we thought at the beginning of the game, and Tony Banks is now in a hole, down 10-0 after the early turnovers. He's got to make big plays. No secret for Michigan State to have a chance today, and it's a little gustier than it appears.
We'll see if that plays tricks with Derek Mason trying to catch this football. He coughed the first one up, didn't get a chance to return the second one. Mason is capable of breaking one long, He holds the Michigan State football record with a 100-yard punt return.
He's the number one punt returner in the Big Ten last year, so he's got the capabilities, just a little careless with the ball on his first one.
He'll get a chance at this one, the third one. Mason started off at the goal line and hurdles up to the 23. And in the ACC, will Florida State ever lose a conference game, John Saunders?
All right, Mark, thanks a lot. It doesn't look like it's going to be today, at least not if the early start is the indication. First and 10 at the 41, E.G. Green, a little reverse action here, 37 yards. Danny Cannell throws a nice block. This gets it inside the 5-yard line, setting up Pooh Bear Williams, who this year has 5 carries and 4 touchdowns. Mark.
Boy, Florida State with an imposing, potent offense once again in 1995. Banks back to pass on first and 10. Has a little time, fires complete to Mason, and now incomplete. It was knocked loose.
Big tackle by Tyrone Williams, the cornerback. The coaches feel Charlie McBride, defensive coordinator, feels Williams is a definite NFL prospect, 4-5 speed. And Banks does a nice job buying himself some extra time, resetting his feet, and makes the good throw. But anytime you don't catch the ball cleanly with your hands and you try to bring it into your body, you run the risk of getting hit in the back and the ball popping out. That was a good stick by Tyrone Williams.
Second down and 10 for Banks. The draw play to Scotty Green, pound for pound, one of the toughest players in college football. He makes it out to the 27-yard line, tackled by Ryan Terwilliger. And a look now at the defensive backfield for the Cornhuskers. Mike Minter, nice to see him back after an injury sidelined him last year, Todd.
Yeah, had a knee injury after the second game, and he was a returning starter. So it is good to have him back. It allowed Tony Veland to move back to his free safety position. And this is a very fast, very talented secondary for Nebraska.
Three wideouts for Michigan State. And Banks goes down at the 22-yard line. Phil Ellis, a Butkus candidate, last week had 5 tackles for losses and gets one right here. The entire defense had 5 sacks last week.
Well, Nebraska has a great pass rush, but right here, here's the linebacker, Ellis. Now, he acts like a fifth defensive back. He's going to come in here and get good pressure. He's going to get the sack. You got the 4 guys rushing. They run a little stunt. The linebacker beats the left guard, and he comes up with the sack again.
Chris Solani into punt. He's standing on his own 8-yard line. Flag down, a low returnable punt. And it's fumbled. It's a live ball. And now it's the Spartans' turn to be on the beneficiary part of a turnover.
We just have to see what the penalty is, though, but a bad decision by the Nebraska special teams to touch that football. Now it's all a matter of what the penalty was at the time of the punt.
Brian Eccles from Michigan State recovered that loose ball. Here's the penalty.
Offside, Nebraska.
Maybe the wind is causing trouble down there.
You can see Terrell Farley must have lined up in the neutral zone. Didn't look like anybody jumped offside, but there was an offside in the neutral zone on the punt and a big play, a big turnover for Michigan State, and they really need to capitalize with this break and stick the ball in the end zone.
Or at least score some points, you would think. First and 10, Banks is going to pass, has time, looking up top and has a man. No, yes, the flag. Nigeia Carter was the intended receiver, and there was a lot of contact down the sideline.
I think that was really a good call, too, Mark. The official right close to the play didn't have a good angle on it. The official in the middle of the formation was able to look in, and Nigeia Carter, he's got great speed, maybe the fastest of all the wide receivers, and got good position on Tyrone Williams.
Pass interference, defense.
Tony Banks, I mean, he's got to be a tough guy because he's going to get hit a lot today. As much as they want to throw the ball, Nebraska is going to try to put shots on him every time they can. That's about the 5th time now he's been hit. Take a look at the end of the play. You can see contact moving into him at the last minute. Michael Booker, number 20, was in there and made the contact.
As a result, first down and 10. The ball at the Nebraska 29-yard line. Ace formation by the Spartans on the waggle. Banks is brought down, but there's a whistle and a flag first.
I think the result's going to be about the same. It looked like a dead ball penalty. Take a look at the play again. At the end, Michael Booker trying to find the ball, and he runs into the receiver.
The penalty is against Michigan State. Some of these fumbles and penalties that we're seeing on the part of the Spartans, Todd, how much do you account that to maybe rust, first game jitters?
Well, a lot of it's the first game jitters, I think. You know, a lot of times you saw them coming out on the field before the game. They're excited. They're full of emotion. And sometimes you're not relaxed as well as you should be. Normally, once you get through the first quarter, you settle down and you play a little bit smarter. Right now, we're seeing a little over-anxiousness on the part of Michigan State.
The handoff. This is Antoine Patrick. Not much happening up the middle. He's brought down to the 35-yard line. On second and 15, Ryan Terwilliger, the Will linebacker, weak side linebacker, making the tackle that time for the Cornhuskers. Nebraska with 7 first-time starters on defense. They lost a total of 14 starters from a year ago. Second and 16. Out of the shotgun, Banks. Complete at the 23, and a nice move by Muhammad. Masin Muhammad with a first down at the 10-yard line for the Spartans. A tackle made by Booker. You have to be impressed with the way Banks delivered the pill.
Tony Banks has got a great arm now, and he's showing that he's got the poise to stay in the pocket. Take a look at him as he sets up in the pocket. Good pass protection up front this time. Makes the great throw. Now watch the move by Muhammad. Fake to the inside, wheeled back to the outside, and that's why they got the big play. Muhammad would have been tackled short of the first down. Watch his quick move. Fake Mike Minner out and added about another 10 yards on the play.
That's out of the offset eye. This is the first time that the Spartans have threatened today. The handoff is to Renaud, breaking a couple of tackles and finally brought down at the 13-yard line. Tyrone Williams and Phil Ellis in on the tackle for the Blackshirts.
Good defense by Nebraska. Michigan State tried to run the counter trap where they pulled the backside guard and tackle, and it was just stuffed at the line of scrimmage. Good penetration by the Nebraska defense. Shut that play down.
Coach Saban said that they wouldn't be able to really have a ball control situation offensively. They're going to have to move things around and get Banks out on the perimeter just a little bit. That time trying the counter. 6:40 remaining in the first quarter. Banks into the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for Carter. Good coverage that time by Mike Minner.
Yeah, good coverage and good disguise by Charlie McBride's defense. They walked up and showed blitz, I think, to Tony Banks. Banks thought he was going to get man-to-man in a blitz look. They backed out and played zone and really had nowhere to go with the football. Tried to throw it to the back corner of the end zone, but great positioning by the safety, Mike Minner.
Todd, it's third down. They can get a first down without scoring a touchdown. Nose of the ball just outside the 11-yard line. Spartans with a trips right formation. Muhammad, Mason, and Carter. Muhammad in motion. And another flag. A little bit sloppy here in the early going.
I think Tony Banks, too, knew that the 25-second clock was running down on him. He was trying to get that play called. They were a little slow getting out of the huddle.
False start. Offense.
This is a mixed crew today, combination of Big 8 and Big 10 officials. Dean Blevins, what's up downstairs?
Well, I think what the problem was in the last play is they're having trouble getting the signals waggled in. Banks didn't understand it a time or two, and by the time he got the play in the huddle, there were only about 10 seconds to go.
A costly penalty, moving the ball back 5 yards.
One you really hate to have in this part of the field. Now you put yourself in a real difficult situation at 3rd and 15.
Banks with time, into the end zone, touchdown Spartans, Muhammad. Tony Banks fired a dart.
So much for difficult situations, right? Third down and 15, just throw a perfect throw for the touchdown. That play was made possible because of great pass protection up front. Watch the pass protection now up front. Watch how long Tony Banks has to wait and wait and wait for his receiver to come all the way across the field into the end zone. Great pass protection up front by Michigan State.
And here's Chris Gardner with the extra point attempt. A low kick that goes through. Tony TNT Banks brings Michigan State a little closer. We'll be right back. Hey, Todd, Tony Banks was in good hands on that last touchdown pass.
Yeah, he really was. We talked about the good protection that he got. Watch up front. Watch these guys. Tony Popovsky, number 69. Bob Denton, 60. The guys on the right side. Look at Banks. He can watch the field. He can read his receiver coming across. And anytime you have a good, clear throwing lane like that, you can make things happen as a quarterback.
He moves the team 76 yards in 10 plays using a little over 340, well, actually 341 on the clock. Capping that drive with a Muhammad 16-yard touchdown pass. And they were aided by a couple of penalties on that drive. Kick 5 yards deep to Childs, and he'll take a knee. Well, coming up next on ABC's College Football, the Fighting Irish and Notre Dame are coming off a disappointing loss last week against Northwestern. The Purdue Boilermakers had an impressive win over West Virginia last week. These longtime rivals hook up in a national showdown next here on ABC. 3:30 Eastern, 12:30 Pacific.
You know, Mark, we talked about at the top of the show that Michigan State had to play well on first down, both offensively and defensively. Right now, Nebraska, to date, averaging 10.8 yards a play on first down. So they've got to try to slow the Huskers down, particularly the option on first down.
Phillips on the carry. Defensively, Michigan State up front has to play well.
Yeah, they do. And Yakini Allen, I mean, look at that number. Number 23, he's a defensive tackle. That's because he was a linebacker last year. But in order for Nick Saban to put the best 11 he could on the field on defense, they had to move him to a defensive line position. He's a little undersized, but very quick.
Under 6 minutes to go in the first period. A two tight end set. Two wideouts for Nebraska. Brazier on the option to the short side of the field, keeps it himself, and is brought down about 2 yards shy of the first down by Jabbar Threat. And a look at the linebacking crew now for the Spartans.
You had to say what the strength of this defense would be. It would be those guys, the linebackers. Reggie Garnett has been a starter for a couple years. Ike Reese, the Will linebacker, a little bit undersized, but a guy who can really run and hit. Loves to play the game of football.
Reese is the guy who comes out in the nickel package. Third down and one. Power football time. Nebraska football. And this is how they do it in Lincoln. Right at you, folks. First down for Phillips out of the 32-yard line. Demetrius Martin led the Big Ten last year with 7 picks. Not many people throw in his neighborhood. Tackle on that last play made by Allen and Garnett. First down for the Cornhuskers. The ball at the 32-yard line. They lead 10-7 with 5:04 remaining here in the first quarter.
See Tommy Frazier call a check with me at the line of scrimmage. He does a lot of audibling in the run game.
Little counter tray here. Phillips hard running out to the 43-yard line right near the first down. And you'll be glad to know that Herbie Husker is back. They announced it today that he would remain a symbol for the Nebraska football program. I've never had a problem with him. I like him.
Herbie looks like he gets into the game. So that's what you want in college football.
So many positive symbols for the Nebraska football program. Model of success. Phillips, the I-back. Three wide receivers on this play. Frazier passes complete to his tight end, Gilman, who dives down to the 48-yard line. Mark Gilman, the tight end, 6'4", 240, a senior, He was the lifter of the year last spring, and that says a lot in the Nebraska strength and conditioning program. Well, tonight starts with an incredible hour, starting two of the world's greatest illusionists, Siegfried and Roy. The magic, the mystery. You won't believe your eyes. Then finish your night with Gremlins 2, the new batch, all tonight on ABC. Full house backfield, Makovica, Schuster, and Phillips this time. This is Makovica, and he's brought down near the line of scrimmage by Yakini Allen. Nice play.
Yeah, really nice play by Yakini Allen. Jeff Makovica, an interesting story. He played eight-man football in high school. You don't hear that too much, but he grew up in Brainerd, Nebraska, played at East Butler High School, and he has a younger brother, Joel, that's also a fullback on this team. Two guys who are very talented eight-man football players, and really a success story now as the starting fullback for the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
That position carries a lot of weight and tradition. 3:22 to play in the first period. The toss to Phillips. Phillips has the first down at the 43. Nebraska's offensive line just keeps pounding and pounding on him. Carl Reeves making the tackle that time. Penn State knotted up at 7-7. Boy, in Michigan, off to a pretty good start this year under Lloyd Carr.
Nebraska really trying to pack it in on Michigan State right now, feeling that they can run the ball right at them. They've got the two tight ends, the three backs in the backfield.
First and 10, little play action, and Frazier has a lot of rug ahead of him. And he fumbles it. The recovery made by the Spartans. Travis Reese has another good bounce for the Spartans. Martin made a nice stick on Frazier to cause the fumble.
But watch, Frazier's just going to fake the bootleg and come out. This is a quarterback run all the way. This is not an option. It's not a pass. Watch as he comes out of the fake. The fullback is just going to block. He's not looking to catch a pass. It's a quarterback bootleg keep. And Frazier, normally very dependable running the football, but that's a great hit in the open field by Demetrius Martin. Look at that stick. Helmet right on the football. Butt up under him. Great tackle and a big play again for Michigan State.
Boy, we have seen a lot of fumbles and turnovers so far here in the first quarter. Scotty Green gets to the perimeter and is forced out of bounds at the 38-yard line. A pickup of about 7 yards on first down. Mike Minner pushing him out of bounds along with Michael Booker, and a flag down too.
Talking to the offensive coordinator, Gary Tranquil, yesterday, he said, you know, the thing about Scott Green, his measurable qualities are not that impressive. He's kind of short, kind of squatty, he's not real fast, not real flashy, but the things you can't measure, his intensity, his heart, how hard he plays the game, I mean, he's a great fullback for this offense. He's been very, very productive. He was the MVP of Michigan State's team last year, voted by his teammates. So, kind of guy that may not show up much in the stats, but you really love to have him on your team.
A lot of fun to watch. He, too, like Makovica, has a brother who plays the same position. And here's Green again. Brought down near the line of scrimmage. Fell down at the 39-yard line. Brought down by Ryan Terwilliger. Set up third down and about 2 yards to go for Michigan State. The Spartans scored on their last possession. Make the score 10-7. 2:26 to play in the first quarter. And there's your score.
Maybe a good situation for Tony Banks to use his snap count here. Maybe draw Nebraska offsides and get the easy first down.
Antoine Patrick is the deep back. Banks is going to keep it himself. And yes, he can run. First down, Michigan State. Downstairs to Dean. Dean?
Guys, number 10, the Grover for Nebraska, tremendous player. Mike Minner has twisted an ankle. He's in, says it's not a huge problem. He had a knee blown out last year and had to miss most of the season. I heard Craig Bowles, the linebacker coach for Nebraska, talk to his defense, said the guy's the biggest problem. We've got to put more pressure on Banks. They can't give this guy 5 seconds to throw. And ironically, that's the strength of the Nebraska defense going against the weakness in protecting for Banks for Michigan State.
Yeah, kudos so far going to that offensive line for the Spartans. Two tight ends set, and offside, that was Josh Kerr, number 83, the Spartan tight end, that jumped a little prematurely.
See, those are mental mistakes. They're not physical mistakes. They don't come from effort. They come from just a lack of concentration.
Dead ball. False start. offense.
You expect a few of those in your first ball game, but when you're playing the number two ranked team in the country, you have to keep those things to a minimum. You can't have negative plays that put you in loss of yardage situations, because Nebraska really likes to get you in a position where they can come after your quarterback.
You mentioned penalties, Todd. Michigan State now, six of them, totaling 50 yards. Nebraska, meanwhile, two for a total of 30. They blitz, and Banks picks it up and finds a receiver about 5 yards short of the first down. That was Nigea Carter. Good poise by Banks that time. We mentioned Mark Renaud filling in for Dwayne Goldburn. There's Goldburn. He's out 4 to 6 weeks with a broken foot. He was their leading rusher a year ago. Second down and 4 to go. No flags. This is Patrick. Maybe gained 1 yard, Todd.
You know, you look at this and you say, well, why is Michigan State running the ball? They're not gaining any yards really running. But what it is doing is it's keeping the Nebraska defense a little bit honest. It's not allowing them to really pin their ears back and only think about rushing the quarterback. That's why you've got to continue to run the ball. You've got to throw screens. You've got to bring your quarterback out of the pocket on the bootleg. You can't set up and throw from the same position every play. Sooner or later, they'll get to you and they'll hurt your quarterback.
Third and two, Todd. Renaud and Green. That's Green in motion. Looks to Green. Has the short of the first down, though. Boy, Mike Minter closed in a hurry and slammed the door on Michigan State and Green.
Yeah, it doesn't look like his ankle bothering him right now, because, as you mentioned, great closing speed to the ball. It looked like Michigan State was going to have the first down as Green caught the football, but excellent work by Mike Minter coming from the safety position.
You know what? There are about 70,000 armchair quarterbacks here at Spartan Stadium who want Coach Nick Saban to go for the first down on 4th and 1.
No reason to at this point. You're in the ball game, and you've withstood the initial flurry by Nebraska.
Well, we are 15 minutes into the first quarter, and it appears that we have a timeout down on the field.
2 seconds on the clock.
They're going to put 2 seconds back on the clock and play it out.
The only reason I can think there is that Nebraska wanted to force Michigan State to kick into the wind here. They may try to come after the punter to force a bad punt to assure themselves good field position. You take a look at the flags blowing. The wind is coming into the face of the Michigan State punter right now. So pretty good decision to use a timeout here by Nebraska.
A beautiful day here at the original land-grant institution. In the country, Michigan State. Monday night on ABC, Jeff Fahey stars in a brand new episode of The Marshall. Then it's the Packers and the Bears, one of the oldest rivalries in the NFL. Action Monday on ABC. Now keep an eye on Terrell Farley, number 43 for Nebraska. He is the designated blocker of punts.
I think he's the guy that got called for offsides, lining up offsides on the last punt situation for Michigan State.
In junior college, he blocked nearly two dozen kicks. Solani gets this one off. A high spiral coming down at the 15. Reggie Ball coughs it up. There's a flag down. Let's see who has it. The Spartans were right in Reggie Ball's face that time. They may not have given him enough room to catch the ball. Hassan Muhammad recovered the loose ball.
Fair catch interference on the kicking team.
This is a tough rule to enforce, Mark. The rule is that you have to give the guy 2 yards of space to make the catch. Now, you know, 2 yards to one guy may not look like 2 yards to another guy. That's a tough call to make for any official.
It's a judgment call. It looked like there was pretty good spacing there. The ball kind of drifted forward, and as the receiver went to handle it, he was too close to the defender.
I think that's a fumble. You can't blame Nick Saban for being upset at that last call.
See, Nick Saban came from the NFL last year. The rule is different in the NFL. It's not a set distance. It's not 2 yards. It's just in the NFL, you've got to give him an opportunity to make the catch. And then once he muffs the ball, he's fair game. And so that's a very close call to have go against you right now on your special teams.
Well, you cannot end the period on an accepted penalty. So although there is no time remaining in the first quarter, that's why we're coming back. If you're Nick Saban, though, you're thinking that things are going fairly well 15 minutes into your tenure here.
Yeah, you got to be real happy, Mark, because, you know, with Nebraska and with their talent, you've got to withstand that initial flurry. Take a look again. I'll tell you what, that's awful close. It looked like Michigan State was honoring that 2 yard area there. And again, it's a judgment call that the official has to make under duress.
The thinking there on the official's part is that they err on the side of safety to protect the player. Which you really can't blame them for.
Nope, you can't.
First and 10 for the Cornhuskers. Phillips likes to bounce it outside, and he's brought down at the 23-yard line. And that effectively will end the first period of play. It's 10-7 for the defending national champs. We'll be right back. Back in East Lansing, Michigan, I'm Mark Jones along with Todd Blackledge and Dean Blevins. This is the first play of the second quarter. Nebraska has a 2nd and 9.
New formation for Nebraska. 4 wide receivers, 1 back in the shotgun. This is not typical Nebraska, and they still run the option.
They pitch it, and Lawrence Phillips has a first down and then some. Phillips out to the 43-yard line, a motivated Nebraska team today, and it's even tougher to motivate a team after a national title. Here's Coach Osborne.
It's easy once you have a great year to say, well, maybe we don't need to work quite as hard. Maybe we can get by, take a shortcut here and there. But I haven't seen that in this football team, and I hope I don't see it, because we're good, but we're not so good that we can back off in any aspect and do well.
The expectations and standards so high in Lincoln. Play action pass, Frazier. Plenty of time, incomplete at the 43, and there's a flag down. Plenty of contact as Joel Makovica tried to make the catch. Robert Shurls making the contact on Makovica. Nebraska and Florida State jockeying for top spot in the AP poll.
This was really pretty good defense by Michigan State, Mark. Carl Reeves, number 55.
Defense.
Talked about Florida State and Nebraska, their competition at the top of the polls. John Saunders has an update on the Seminoles.
Well, Mark, beware Pooh Bear, as in Pooh Bear Williams, 266-pound fullback, 6 carries for 19 yards this year, 5 touchdowns, 5 yards on that one. Mark, back to you.
Poo be poo, man. Never heard of them before.
You talk about programs that reload like Nebraska. Florida State reloads every year, too.
First and 10. The give is to the fullback, Clinton Childs. Let's take a look at our first quarter statistics. Schuster on that last carry.
You take a look on the rushing yards, as you would expect from Nebraska, 125 yards in that first quarter, but the turnovers really kind of what's kept both this game even. 2 turnovers from Michigan State, 1 for Nebraska. Points off turnovers, Nebraska 10 points. They're very effective creating opportunities from your mistakes.
Michigan State with 90 total yards offense. Last week, Oklahoma State only had 1 yard of total offense after the first quarter. This is Childs, who has nowhere to go. Strung out nicely by Wright and Treese.
It's See, Clinton Childs has been working as the fullback primarily this year, but Damon Benning is not on the trip with a hamstring, so now Childs is at tailback. You see, he took a bad course on that counter trap play. Frazier was expecting him to be a little bit deeper. They ran into each other, and that disrupted the timing of the play. Watch as they run into each other. The play is dead right there. Good support then by Sherrill, by Michigan State, to make it a loss of yardage situation. But Clinton Childs just not used to playing tailback as much this season as in seasons past.
He didn't make the trip last week to Oklahoma State because of a disciplinary problem. Phillips back in the game in this full house backfield. Third down, six to go. Option time and down time for Tommy Frazier. A nice defensive sequence for the Spartan defensive unit. Threets making the tackle. We have been calling his name a lot this afternoon.
Jabbar Threets got the tackle. Travis Reese, the outside linebacker, made the play because he forced Tommy Frazier to turn it in, and Frazier is limping off the field. Looks like he may have hurt a hamstring or a hip.
He came into the game, Todd, with a slight hip pointer injury. And as you know from playing, those are tough ones to get over.
Yeah, they're tough to come back. We'll have to get Dean's report on Tommy Frazier, but Travis Reese, the outside linebacker, did a great job turning that play back to the inside and forcing the short gain by Tommy Frazier.
There's Brooke Behringer, the backup quarterback, and really shouldn't say backup. It's more of a 1-1A situation for the Cornhuskers. They said that he would play in the second quarter, maybe the first or second series. Here's the punt from Jesse Cush. Barely got it off. Should be able to down this inside the five. They down it right at the five-yard line. Joel Makovica was there, but concern on the Husker sideline because of Tommy Frazier's hip. We'll find out more when we come back. Tommy Frazier writhing in pain, Todd.
Yeah, it's kind of a freak injury. Take a look as we watch the end of this play. Jabbar Threets is going to come in to make the tackle. And right there, you can see it's a knee into the thigh area just above the pad of Tommy Frazier. And it looks like a severe Charlie horse type injury, kind of a freak injury to get on a play like that. But as you can see, Frazier in a lot of pain on the Nebraska sideline.
That doesn't help his health status. He came into this game, as I mentioned earlier, with a hip pointer as well. But it's time for Tony Banks. Looking up top and overthrows Carter. Downstairs to Dean Blevins for more on that injury.
Guys, we're just a few feet away from Tommy Frazier, as you saw, in a lot of pain. We don't have a definitive word from them, but they're bringing some hip pads, so it appears it would not be a snapped hamstring or a knee, so that's good news for Nebraska. He is now walking away, so it appears to be something in the hip region.
Well, I guess that means that we will definitely see Brooke Behringer on the next series for the Cornhuskers.
The thing that really hurts Nebraska, though, is that's got to slow him down as a runner, and that's really Tommy Frazier's strength, is his ability to run the option.
That's out of the offset eye. They run it. Renaud turns it back inside and stuff at the six-yard line. It'll set up third down and long for Michigan State.
It's a critical play now for Tony Banks here in a desperate situation. Third down and about nine to go deep in your own territory. You've made good decisions to this point. You've had a good game to this point. You don't want to make a bad decision here and throw the ball into coverage. You don't want to take a sack. Get rid of the football. Get as much yardage as you can and hope that you can punt the ball out of this territory. So a big play here for Tony Banks.
Three wide receivers out on this play. He's been getting good protection so far today. Gets it off in time, looking for Muhammad, and it's picked off by Minter. Mike Minter played center field and hauled that one in. And it's another Spartan turnover.
The first down play, Tony Banks took a shot at the deep one, and he did the right thing. He threw it deep. Only his guy had a chance. This one, he underthrew a little bit. And Minter was able to make the play. You could see double coverage by Nebraska, and probably not the best decision Tony Banks could have made of where to throw the football on that one.
Pressure that time, too, coming from Jared Tomich. There was a flag down, and it's against
Michigan
State.
Illegal formation, offense, decline, first down.
That is the third turnover of the afternoon for Michigan State.
compared to one for Nebraska.
Now, Mark, in essence, this works out to be almost like a punt because it's a long interception. And there was no return on the play by Minter, but still, you don't like to have that feeling that you threw it into coverage and made that kind of a choice.
And Todd, here's a look at Brooke Behringer out of Goodwin, Kansas, 7-0 as a starter, coming in relief here for Tommy Frazier. The give is to the fullback, Jeff Makovica. And he's tackled by Jabbar Threet. Man, I'm really impressed by Threet so far today. He's been in on a lot of tackles and has more often than not been on the top of piles as opposed to the bottom. More on Tommy Frazier from Dean. Dean?
Guys, what they've done to him is put a thigh pad, they've wrapped into his thigh pad with some tape, so it's not the region of the hip that we thought it was. Seems to be a strange injury, and perhaps, we hate to speculate, but Todd, I think you may have been right. Just got a Charlie horse, but he's in pain.
Ace formation, this is Phillips. Look at those feet. They are so sweet. Phillips with a first down to the 19-yard line. Travis Reese finally corralled it. You can just see him picking his spots, waiting for that opening, Todd.
Well, John Vedro is going to get a great block. Here he is in the slot. Watch him come in and crack right here, get a block. And as Phillips comes out, he's just going to wait. He's going to wait for the play to develop. There's the block on the perimeter by Vedro. Phillips just allows it to happen, turns it upfield, and it's a big play. Vedro with the key block on the play.
Phillips, 12 rushes for a total of 127 yards. That's why he's a Heisman candidate. Here's the counter trade. And he's got more room. Lawrence Phillips down to the 2-yard line. Move those sticks. First down, Cornhuskers. The tackle by Carl Reeves.
The only way to stop the counter trade play is to get penetration on the line of scrimmage. Nebraska denied penetration. Watch the left guard and left tackle pull. There's no penetration. The guard kicks out. The tackle leads through. Mark, you could run through that hole. I'm telling you, those guys got up through the hole. They opened it up. No one there to make the tackle on Phillips.
Well, thank you very much, Tom. It was pretty large. Full house backfield. Phillips in the house. Touchdown, Nebraska. That's how they do it, folks. And a flag now after the play, a dead ball play. Lawrence Phillips showing you why he's a Heisman Trophy candidate. 16 touchdowns a year ago, adding to his total there.
A sportsmanlike defense, a sportsmanlike offense.
It's called a wash.
You know, the thing about Lawrence Phillips is that he's 220 pounds. Now, we've seen him get on the perimeter and make the play because of his burst and acceleration, but he also has great strength. He has great body strength and the ability to take it up inside, to go up over the top. He's very durable. You know, they had a lot of problems keeping their quarterbacks healthy last year. The one guy they could count on in that national championship year was Lawrence Phillips.
Here's Brown with the extra point. That drive, four plays, 41 yards, using a little over a minute on the clock. And Nebraska taking a 17-7 lead. Lawrence Phillips, LP, that's long play. It's a touchdown play. Tommy Frazier making his way into the locker room. Bad news for the Cornhuskers. Good news is, Todd, that they lead 17-7, and they really don't drop off that much with Brooke Behringer coming in.
No, they'll run their same offense. That's the beauty of their quarterback situation, is Behringer runs all the same plays that Frazier does. Maybe a little better thrower, maybe not quite as good of an option runner, but they won't change anything.
He moved the team downfield nicely in that last offensive series. Lawrence Phillips capping it with a touchdown. Nebraska with over 200 yards total offense so far. Mason at the goal line. Mason popped at the 24-yard line. Let's take another look at that score by Nebraska.
You know, the reason you give the ball to the fullback in this offense is so he'll do this when you need him. Watch the lead block by the fullback on the linebacker. Makovica coming in there, going to smack the linebacker. Lawrence Phillips is able to dive right to his inside for an easy touchdown for Nebraska. You give the fullback the ball a couple times to keep him interested so that he'll go in and make those tough blocks when he has to.
The Cornhuskers always keep you guessing. Green in motion. The give is to Antoine Patrick, who gets jacked at the 27-yard line. Big day of college football here on ABC. Excuse me, I'm a little bit excited about the prospect of seeing Notre Dame take on Purdue. That's coming up next. Notre Dame upset last week against Northwestern. Purdue with a huge win last week against West Virginia. And how will the Irish respond? That is the $64,000 question. Well, the band's still into it. Spartans trailing by 10 points on second down and 8. Banks throwing an interception to set up that last Nebraska touchdown on their last possession. He's going to take it himself. Tucks that ball away just in the nick of time and is tackled at the 32. Downstairs to Dino.
Thanks, guys. Tom Izzo joins me now. New basketball coach, although he's been around here for a while. New football coach, new athletic director. It's new year around here.
It's exciting time for all of us around here, Dean, and hopefully the way the game's going, we can hang in there and maybe pull off a big upset today.
Well, your relationship with Nick Saban goes back.
And Nick and I have been good friends. The first year he came here as an assistant, I came here as an assistant. I kind of hung in there, he moved around, and now we're reunited, and it's been great.
All right, Tom, thanks. Good luck this year.
Thanks, Dean.
Back to you guys.
All right, a real renaissance period here in East Lansing. Boy, it's tough to think about basketball without Judd Heathcote. Flags down. Pass complete to Mason at the 36-yard line. That's where his forward progress will be marked. But there's a flag down at the 33. Phil Ellis making the tackle for Nebraska defensively. When Banks has time, Michigan State can accomplish a few things.
Yeah, he's got great tools. I mean, he has great arm.
Offense. Second time we've seen that infraction called against the Spartans. Downstairs back to Dean on Frazier.
Guys, left thigh bruise for Tommy Frazier. They don't know if he will return, so in the long haul, that's good news for Nebraska.
All right, Dean, and just as those words rolled off your tongue, I see Frazier coming out of the tunnel, walking very gingerly. Another look at that last completion by Banks.
Watch Banks. Good poise in the pocket. He read the coverage to his left, came back to his right, and the reason you get those penalties is because when you try to use three and four wide receivers, you have to have certain number of guys up on the line of scrimmage. You got to be in the right position or you'll get that penalty.
Out of the shotgun. They try to get him out of the pocket. Banks has Muhammad. First down, a big play by Tony Banks to Muhammad.
Wow. This, you don't know how good a play this is by Tony Banks, because he just strong-armed that. He was getting hit as he threw it, and he just kind of slung it with his arm and threw it about 35 yards down the field for the big completion. It was a blitz by Nebraska, man-to-man coverage. Watch Tony Banks. He doesn't get any body or legs into this throw. As he pulls up, here comes the hit behind him. He just slung it downfield and came up with the big completion.
Man, that does say a lot about his arm strength.
It sure does.
7 of 11, 106 yards. And Tony Banks with a big play to keep the drive alive on 3rd and 8. It's 1st and 10 now. 3 wideouts for the Spartans. And they put it on the ground. It appeared to be a poor snap.
You know what I think happened here? I think the center, Matt Beard, didn't realize his quarterback was in the shotgun. He thought he was up under center, and he snapped a short snap instead of the long shotgun snap. Scott Green very alertly fell on the football, but I think this might be what happens. Watch as the center snaps it. Is he going to pull it right up to his butt? Yeah, he thought the quarterback was under center. Now, how you don't know that he's there, I don't know, but a heads-up play by Scott Green.
Todd, you play the position. You would think if you're a center that you'd be able to feel the quarterback's hands under your posterior.
You would think.
Here's Scotty Green down to the 42-yard line. I know I might. Coming up in the potential halftime report, John Saunders, scores and highlights from all of today's action, plus Robin Roberts on Notre Dame's fall from grace. And don't forget that we have Notre Dame and Purdue coming up next.
Purdue off a great win at West Virginia last week. They'll be laying in wait for the Irish, thinking maybe this is the year that they can get after them a little bit.
Yeah, Purdue with a nice running game. And Jim Coletto has done a great job there. 7:25 to play in the first half. This time they get the snap to Banks. Completes the pass to his tight end, Luke Bensy. A 6'3", 218-pound senior is tackled by Tony Veland.
Well, here's the blitz coming from Nebraska. Terwilliger's going to blitz. Banks is going to read it. He's going to hit the little out route, but good coverage on the outside by Tyrone Williams. Watch as the blitz comes. Banks is going to read it.
He's going to see that he has to get rid of the football, but a good tackle in the open field by Tyrone Williams.
It's fourth down and eight. Cellini into punt, and keep an eye on Terrell Farley. Always a threat to block a punt for Nebraska. He's number 43. Cellini tries to pooch this one, and Muhammad couldn't get a hand on it. Gave it a nice try and may have injured himself in the process. A 40-yard punt, nothing on the return. 17-7 for the Cornhuskers. The medical staff of the Cornhuskers still working on Tommy Frazier, who injured that left thigh just moments ago.
See, the problem with that injury, Mark, is it won't get any better today. It will continue to tighten up, so I don't think we'll see any more of Tommy Frazier in this ball game.
Penn State, another Big Ten team in action today. They're taking on Texas Tech. There's a flag down at the 25-yard line. Clinton Childs on the carry.
Incidental face mask, defense.
Boy, what's that, the third one we've seen today? John Saunders, what's up with Penn State and Texas Tech?
Well, Mark, Penn State having some trouble hanging onto the ball following a fumbled punt sets this up. Zebby Lethbridge to field Scoville, 20 yards on the play, and Texas Tech takes a 14-7 lead. Mark.
Anything can happen. You know, the one area where when a team's playing their first game, where one of the problems comes up is special teams, execution of special teams. Fumble punt led to a touchdown.
We've seen that happen in our game today. This is Trials trying to get to the perimeter and turn the corner, pushed out of bounds at the 42-yard line. And we saw Muhammad injure himself moments ago. Dean, what's his situation?
Well, he has a golf ball-sized knot. His ankle turned to the outside, his left one did, and it doesn't look real good. You know, we talked to Coach Osborne yesterday about the turf injuries, and you see that the turf could have caused this, but Tom was pretty defiant, saying that there aren't conclusively more injuries on turf versus grass.
Well, there certainly is more grab on the field than there is on a grass field, and that's what happened there. He tried to turn back to catch the football, and his foot, there was no give in his foot.
That thing turned right over on him. Clinton Childs showing you the depth of the running game at Nebraska. Case in point, learned his lesson from that disciplinary problem a week ago and is back in action and looking good. Reese and Charrell's on the tackle.
And they just keep coming at you, Mark. I mean, right now the Michigan State first team defense has to be getting a little bit tired. It's game conditions, it's hot down on the field, and Nebraska keeps rolling in new people, new linemen, new running backs. And take a look from last year, Nebraska, the number one rushing team in the country, Michigan State defense 104 in the country, and that's where they're weak right now, and they're getting attacked on the inside.
So at that time it was a 25-yard gain. Perringer on the quick three-step drop, incomplete, intended for Reggie Ball, who got spanked at the 28-yard line by Sean Hart, a nickelback. It'll be second down and 10. But you know, you talk about Nebraska offensively, so many specialty groups that the coaches talk about and their personnel.
And that's been the biggest change, I think, in Nebraska's offensive philosophy over the last several years is now what they do is they bring in a lot of different formations, different personnel groupings, but they run the option out of all of them. So you have to prepare defensively for each personnel grouping and how do you defend the option. And they find a weakness. They show you all these formations, all these groups of people, and as soon as they find an area they can exploit, that's what they stay with.
So far, Todd, they've exploited their ground game, 230 yards rushing. The pitch on the option. Childs again, brought down at the first down marker at the 25-yard line. Charrell's making the tackle.
You know, Mark, Dean Blevins played. He had an opportunity to play against Nebraska through his career, had great success as a quarterback at Oklahoma. And, Dean, this offense has changed. Their philosophy of running the option has changed some over the years, hasn't it?
Well, their philosophy of running it has. Certainly it has defending it with more speed. But, yeah, you're right. The quarterback now does not have – it's not a true triple option. It's essentially a double option. And Frazier, they like to put him on the corner with and keep him protected, Todd, so that he's not going to take any unnecessary pops. But he's just a tailback taking snaps most of the time.
The formula works. The give is to the fullback, Brian Schuster, the 225-pound junior.
Yeah, I need to.
And the Michigan Wolverines down in Ann Arbor, just down the street, leading Memphis 7-0. Tim Biakabatuka back in form.
Syracuse starting quickly this season after their big win against North Carolina in the opener up on East Carolina early in that ball game. So Paul Pasqualoni trying to get things squared away up there in Syracuse.
Lawrence Phillips is the eye back. 5:10 remaining in the first half. Behringer, quick three-step drop, complete to number five, Brendan Holbein, who's hit immediately at the 19-yard line.
You wonder how Demetrius Martin made 7 interceptions last year to lead the Big Ten. Well, he didn't get an interception on this play, but he read it so quickly. He read the three-step drop, and he was right up there. It was a very short gain. That was well played, man-to-man coverage by the corner, Demetrius Martin.
He is the strength of that defensive backfield, number 21, rated as a professional prospect.
Here's a
third and four.
Another big play from Michigan State. I'd expect to see them try to run the option with Behringer. You see he's checking off where the defensive weakness is.
It's that ace formation. It's on the ground. Did Phillips get it back? Whose ball is it?
Phillips had it initially, Mark, and I think the Michigan State defender, Marvin Wright, tried to steal it from him. They're going to call it Nebraska ball just because I'm not sure they saw it clearly, but Phillips kind of went a little bit lackluster after the football, and I think Marvin Wright stole the ball from him. Watch as they come down the line. It's a bad pitch by Behringer, a little low and outside, and as Phillips goes after it, Marvin Wright steals it from him right there. At that point, I think Marvin Wright has the football, but the official didn't see it clearly, and they gave it back to Nebraska. That could have been a big turnaround break for Michigan State.
And Nick Saban fuming over that one. In to attempt a field goal now. From 47 yards out is Chris Brown. In high school, he kicked a 53-yarder. This would be a career long for the freshman. Plenty of leg. Man, that thing was a rocket blast. With room to spare. Is there helium in that football? I mean, he just crushed it. And it's 20-7 for the Cornhuskers.
Coming into the season, this was one of the question marks about Nebraska after losing Darren.
Yeah, Shager, he's gone.
Nice job by Chris Brown. Plenty of leg as he knocked that one through. And kicking is so much a part of confidence.
As I said earlier, in high school, he kicked a 53-yarder. That bodes well for the kicking future for Nebraska. Tomorrow night on ABC, it's an hour of You at Your Best, America's Funniest Home Videos, followed by Lois and Clark. Then Rebecca De Mornay stars in a classic suspense thriller. This was one of my favorites. I would have never let that lady in the house. The Hand That Rocks the Cradle. All tomorrow night here on ABC.
Mentioning the kicking situation for Nebraska, we knew that they would be strong offensively. They returned some good players on defense. But kicking, Tom Seiler was their field goal and PAT kicker last year. He's gone. Darren Erstead was their punter who led the nation in net punting last year, and he was the number one pick by the California Angels in the June draft of baseball. So they really came into the season with a freshman kicker, the first time that Tom Osborne's ever had a true freshman kicker and an untested punter. But so far the kicking game looks pretty solid for the Huskers.
And this kick comes down at the 6-yard line. Mason got to tuck that thing away and is brought down at the 20-yard line with just under 3.5 minutes to play, 3:29 to play in the first half. Nebraska leading 20-7. And just a reminder, coming up at halftime, John Saunders with scores and highlights on the Prudential Halftime Report. And Robin Roberts will take a closer look at the situation with the Notre Dame Fighting Irish, who, by the way, play next in the second half of our doubleheader here on ABC as they take on Purdue. That's out of the eye. Renaud is the eye back. And he gets the carry. Flag down at the 22. The Nebraska defense really pursues that ball, Todd. Veland making the tackle, assisted by Luther Harden. Let's see what these penalties are about.
Offside. Defense.
The penalty is against Nebraska. Look at action in the Big Ten today. I really think that Michigan, Todd, is better than most people thought they might be coming into the season.
I think people thought that there would be a lot of, just uncertainty with the Lloyd Carr situation. How would the team respond to what happened in the offseason? But that seems to be a team that is playing with a lot of resolve right now. We saw them last week, and they were very impressive in their win over Illinois.
Illinois taking on Oregon today, and you get a look at Oregon next week against UCLA. That's where we'll be, out in Pasadena. Banks fumbled the snap. Renaud gets the handoff, and he'll be about 4 yards short of the first down. On first and five.
You watch this Nebraska defense, and they've changed over the years. The offense has changed some. The defense has really changed. Now it's geared towards speed. It used to be a 50 defense that was more geared towards big people. Look at that. The average weight of the Nebraska defense, 226 pounds. The only two really big guys are the two Peter brothers on the inside. Everyone else is basically a linebacker that can run. And this team is built on speed, getting up the field with your outside rushers and running to the football.
Banks with time. Fires incomplete at the 34 for Carter. Mike Minter providing solid coverage once again. And Banks getting off the carpet again, too.
Take a look. Now, Tony Banks knows if you throw the ball this much against a good defense, you're going to get hit. Now, the initial hit doesn't hurt there. What hurts is when you land on this hard turf with a big body on top of you. That's what hurts. I mean, the initial contact was not much, but having a 300-pounder land on top of you, that hurts. And I'll tell you what, it takes a toll on you after a while.
It's like falling off a 100-story building. It's not the fall. It's that sudden stop at the end. 2:28 to play in the first half. High snap out of the shotgun. Banks completes the pass at the 35-yard line, and that will be a first down for Michigan State. Napoleon Outlaw making his first reception of the afternoon. Outlaw, a senior at 5'10 and 173 pounds. And want to mention once again that we haven't seen Masin Muhammad come back into the game since spraining his ankle.
Yeah, that's why Outlaw is in there now as the third receiver. Going to have to come through for him here in this two-minute drill.
Be a good situation for Michigan State to get a score on the board before the end of this first half. 2:05 to play. Another poor snap, and once again, Scotty Green is forced to pounce on the loose ball. Matt Beard, the center, struggling a little bit today. Seen three poor snaps. One time failing to recognize that Banks wasn't even underneath him. Texas Tech having a little success, John Saunders, huh?
Mark, more than a little success. Zebby Lethbridge here swings it out to Byron Hansbard, and he does the rest of the work for the touchdown. They lead 27 after missing the point after, Mark.
Trouble brewing in State College, huh? 1:20 to play. Banks fires another bullet to the 39, complete to Derek Mason.
I think right now Tony Banks needs to kind of speed the tempo up a little bit. They've made some plays. They're out around the 40-yard line, but they're just entering under a minute to play. They've got a chance to maybe get in field goal range, try to put some more points on the board, but they've got to pick up the tempo here now in the two-minute offense.
Chris Gardner has a strong leg. Banks under pressure, lucky to get away, and he fumbles it. Michigan State appeared to get the fumble back. But it has been tough on Tony Banks all afternoon. He'll be sore after this one.
Take a look from behind now. This is the kind of situation that Nebraska wants to get you into. Christian Peter, number 55, gets a good pressure from the inside. Banks wasn't able to secure the ball, but Fozell Adams, I think, there to fall on the football.
Michigan State, 4th and 12 when we come back. There's a look at injured receiver Masin Muhammad of Michigan State. Twisted his ankle on that pooch punt when he tried to down it inside the 5, and he may be finished for the afternoon.
It's a
big loss for them because really on offense, the strength of this team is their quarterback and their wide receivers. And Muhammad, a fifth-year senior, a guy they were counting on to make some plays, was off to a pretty good game, too, in the first half.
Of little consolation, they do have a lot of depth at that position. That is one of their strongest positions offensively, with Mason and Outlaw and Carter. Here's the punt. Comes down to the 25, Reggie Ball. Ball steps out of bounds, stopping the clock at the 42-yard line. A 42-yard punt that time. And a nice return by Reggie Ball. So Nebraska now, if they manage the clock correctly, might be able to tack a few more points on the board here. And just a reminder that coming up next, Notre Dame, Purdue, the second half of our double dip here on ABC. I'm still trying to get over that field goal, that good field goal by Chris Brown. A 47-yarder that had at least 10 yards to spare. Here's Behringer in the flat to Childs. Childs doesn't get out of bounds. He's close to the first down at the 50-yard line, tackled by Marvin Wright.
Nice job by Marvin Wright keeping him in bounds, too, because Nebraska only has one timeout left, and they didn't really want to burn it on that play. Childs really should have tried to get out of bounds once he got as much yardage as he could.
What's Tom Osborne looking to do here with 9 seconds to play in the first half?
Well, I think you take a shot at one now. They ran the screen on the first down. If they have the first down, the clock will stop until they reset the chain, so you've got a little bit of time to get in there and do something, but take one shot to try to get it down around the 35-yard line and bring Chris Brown in again and let him try to bomb one again.
They're going to measure for the first down.
It's a first down, so now the clock will stop until they reset the ball and reset the chain. So Behringer can get his team set on the line of scrimmage, make sure they have the play called. I would expect to see him make one throw and then use the timeout if they get a completion.
Nebraska leading 20-7. Brooke Behringer in relief of Tommy Frazier, who was injured, suffered a thigh injury in the second quarter.
Just put 5 seconds back on the clock. There's now 14 seconds left, so
and the clock is, well, Behringer spiked it. I'm not sure why, but the whistle blew before the play. Second down and 10. A lot of whistles, a lot of confusion down on the field. Trying to figure this one out.
If you're Michigan State defensively right now, they're playing a four deep, kind of a prevent defense. You want to keep everything up in front of you. You don't want to give up the big play over your head. Make them catch the ball underneath and then come up and make a good tackle.
Behringer gonna try and get out of bounds, and he does, stopping the clock with 5 seconds to go. The ball on the 44-yard line. Still a stretch in terms of a field goal for Chris Brown.
That was good defense by Michigan State because the scramble took 9 seconds, or actually took 7 seconds. Now you only have 5 seconds left. You don't have much time to do anything here. Maybe a three-step drop, a quick throw, try to give yourself a chance, or go ahead and try to throw one to the end zone right here.
5 seconds to play in the first half. Pass is incomplete, and the clock stops with 2 seconds to go, intended for Brendan Holbein. Aldi Henry made the defensive play for Michigan State. This first half, very typical of Nebraska offensively. Chewing up a lot of yards on the ground. And there's a look at the place kicker, Chris Brown. Play action, Behringer throws underneath. That's Bedrill. And Bedrill is tackled at the 14-yard line by Reggie Garnett. And that's the end of the first half of play in the Nick Saban era here in East Lansing in Spartan Stadium. Coming up, the Prudential Halftime Report. John Saunders will have all the scores and highlights for you. And our score at halftime, the defending national champs, Nebraska, leading Michigan State 20-7. And let's go downstairs to Dean Blevins, who spoke with Coach Tom Osborne.
First, Coach, tell us about Frazier and then your perspective of the first half.
Well, Tommy's got a thigh bruise, and right now they're saying it'd be very doubtful that he'll play, but being the kind of guy he is, if he had to, I imagine he'd go out there and hand off a little bit, but he is hurt. First half, some good, some bad. You know, we executed fairly well. Had a couple turnovers that hurt bad, a couple errors in the kicking game, but we've got a good football team, and hopefully we'll get stronger as the game goes along. We'll just have to see.
Thanks, Coach.
Okay, Dean.
Tom Osborne, man, the master of the understatement, huh? Chris Gardner's going to kick off, and back deep, it's Clinton Chiles and Reggie Ball, number 7 for Nebraska. Nick Saban in his debut as Michigan State head coach, his team trailing. This is Chiles at the 14. Sloppy tackling, and Chiles is still on his feet. Across midfield and down to the 46-yard line. And I counted 4 missed tackles, and that doesn't make Nick Saban happy. And Dean Blevins spoke with him moments ago.
Okay. Nick, a couple of bright spots, but miscues, the difference so far.
I think we've had 4 or 5 penalties on misformations and in motion penalties. We dropped 4 or 5 balls. We fumbled the ball the first 2 times we had possession of it. We've given away about 6 points. We need to play a little bit better on defense. So we can get the ball back, and we just got to keep playing hard and getting some turnovers.
Besides the mistakes, what do you tell your team at hand?
Well, I just think that it's more our execution and what we can do than it is what they are or what they can do. And if we execute and catch the ball, protect the quarterback, don't turn it over, we'll have a chance to do a good job.
Thanks for talking with us.
Thank you.
Sometimes easier said than done. Makavika on that carry for Nebraska, gaining a couple of yards, tackled by Garnett and Wright. A sold-out Spartan Stadium in East Lansing, Michigan. And a look at the first half statistics. The telling stat, 240 yards on the ground for the Cornhuskers.
Yeah, and the 3 turnovers by Michigan State. We heard Nick Saban talking about it. Also, 9 penalties in that first half for the Spartans.
There's Phillips, who had 137 yards in the first half. Todd, let's update some of the storylines heading into this contest.
Well, Nebraska, we talked about protecting the football, 1 turnover. They've put pressure on Tony Banks. They've hit him. You don't see a lot of sacks, but they've hit him a lot of time. Banks has played pretty well, for the most part, good decisions. First down, only 4.4 yards per play. Nebraska's averaged over 8 yards per play. The big plays, Lawrence Phillips has had 4 runs over 18 yards, so they've got to cut him down. Lawrence Phillips limping off the field right now. That's one way to slow him down, have him out of the ball game.
Sure is, and Clinton Chiles comes in to take his place. Base formation, 2 tights and 2 wideouts.
This is an option down.
And they hand it off to Chiles, who has the first down, and then some. Move the sticks. Ball is marked at the 27-yard line. Robert Charell is making the tackle. Clinton Chiles, a 6-foot, 215-pound senior.
It's just amazing how they continue to just keep coming at you. Watch the offensive line. Watch the right side. No penetration. You get white jerseys getting the great push. You see Clinton Chiles is 5 yards downfield before a green jersey's even near him. That's great push by the offensive front. They come off as a unit. They really move the middle of that pile, and you're down to your number 3 or number 4 tailback running the football, and it doesn't look any different.
The give is to the fullback. You've got to keep an eye on him because they'll surprise you with Makavika once in a while just to keep you honest, and that's what they do on that play. Sherrell's again making the tackle, and a bad sign when your safeties are making all the tackles. A look at Nebraska's first half possessions. Field goal, touchdown, fumble. And their last 2 possessions result in 10 points.
I think what Nebraska has come to figure right now is that the best chance they have to move the football against Michigan State is to attack the inside defensive lineman, to bring 2 tight ends and run at this defense.
And Behringer is going to keep it himself. He can run. He does have 4.6 speed. Maybe not as fast as Frazier, but He does have good feet, and Dean Blevins has more on Lawrence Phillips.
Guys, Lawrence Phillips' left ankle is simply being taped over the shoe, so a twisted ankle, and he is likely to return. But you've got two Heisman candidates injured in the same day.
Huh, interesting.
I think that tells a lot right there. 137 yards, Lawrence Phillips, only 16 yards for Michigan State. We knew Michigan State would not come in trying to run the ball first. They were going to throw the ball, but had not had much success at all running the football. Fumble.
Let's see who got this back. It appears the Cornhuskers got it back. Childs pouncing on the loose ball. And Behringer was there as well. Interesting to think that so many people in Lincoln put pressure on Tom Osborne before he won that national title, perceived as not being able to win the big one when they've won so many huge games during his tenure.
Now they've averaged 10 wins almost his entire career, though. I mean, he's had great success, but I guess until he won that big game last year, that was just the one he had to get over with.
On second down, the fullback, Makavica, pounding his way down to the 6-yard line where he's tackled by Carl Reeves, number 55.
Part of the Nebraska philosophy is that we're going to play a lot of people. We're going to play two offensive lines. We're going to play a lot of running backs. We're going to keep fresh legs coming at you. And sooner or later, we believe that we can wear you down. If we can keep your defense on the field, we're going to keep pounding on the inside at you. These defensive tackles for Michigan State, Yakini Allen and Chris Smith, neither one of them much over 250 pounds. So they are really having a tough time on the inside.
Todd, time to see who's got skills on third and goal. Behringer keeps it. Makes it down to the 3-yard line, fourth and goal. You kick the field goal? Where do you go for it? It's fourth down, and in comes the place kicker. Carl Reeves making the stop on Behringer. Chris Brown has already made two field goals today, coming from 22 and 47 yards out.
Kick the field goal here, Mark, because it gives you a 23-7 lead if you make it. And the more points you get on this team, the more you force Michigan State into a throw-only situation on offense, and that plays into your hands to rush the passer on defense.
The freshman says no problem on the chip shot. Chris Brown out of South Lake, Texas, with 9 points. Nebraska leads 23-7. The Cornhuskers taking their first possession of the third period, 9 plays, 44 yards, capping it off with a field goal by Chris Brown, who kicks off now. And this will land about 8 yards deep in the end zone, and Derek Mason, with a good career decision, takes a knee. Downstairs to Dean Blevins, who has a special guest.
Yes, he is Dr. Merritt Norvell, the new athletic director here at Michigan State. How about a brief resume for us, Doctor?
Well, I've spent 8 years as assistant dean of the graduate school at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. I spent 17 and a half years with the IBM Corporation. I ran my private company in marketing and distribution for 2 years and served on the athletic board for the University of Wisconsin during the turnaround, did the color for the football games, and had a couple of radio shows.
Well, change is the prevalent word up here.
That's right. In order for us to get better and be the best, we think we have to make some changes. So we're in the process of hiring a new baseball coach. We've got a new associate athletic director coming in for marketing, promotions, and external affairs, and we hope to close on a new track coach this week.
Thanks, Coach. You're headed down, or excuse me, Doctor, you're headed down the right path.
Thank you very much.
All right, back to the booth.
All right. He's done a little bit of everything, probably coached at some point, too. An impressive resume. And we might add that they are doing things the right way here in East Lansing in this renaissance period of athletics.
And I don't know about the other coaches, but I do know Nick Saban's a good football coach, and he is thrilled to be back here on campus at East Lansing. I think he'll get this thing turned around.
He was here during the period 1983 to 87 when they last played in the Rose Bowl. And a nice catch by Derek Mason and a first down out to the 46-yard line. Michael Booker making the tackle.
Good protection up front. And again, as we've seen all ball game, when Tony Banks has the time to stand in the pocket and read the field, he has got the physical ability to make the good throw downfield. That's not an easy throw to make the deep square in, but he had good protection, good field vision, and made the nice throw.
9:25 remaining in the third period. Renaud in motion to the top of your screen. Mason split to the bottom. It's a counter to Scott Green. Breaking tackles. Green picks up about 9 yards. He literally stepped over Phil Ellis at the line of scrimmage. Christian Peter making the tackle for Nebraska.
Good penetration again by the Nebraska defense, and it's a situation when they try to run that counter trap, there's so much traffic there, but that time Scott Green did a nice job just avoiding the commotion. Watching the bottom of the screen. Penetration, they knock the guard to tackle off. Green can't follow his blocker, but a nice little sidestep picks up a decent game.
Patrick in motion. They hand it off again to Scott Green. Getting a little bit of work. There's a flag down at the 45-yard line. Could be, might be, holding. Tackle made by Peter again, and Jay Foreman, number 56.
Holding. Offense.
And it's against the Spartans.
Well, the older Peter made the tackle. The younger Peter is the guy who got held. Jason Peter was being held in there on the inside. And, again, a tough break. They had 9 penalties in the first half, Michigan State. This is a big one, too, because they were in second and very short situation.
Nick Saban hoping to turn around the fortunes of his team this afternoon. Trailing 23-7. Getting paid handsomely for this job. His first job was as a 7th grader pumping gas at his dad's gas station, the Gulf Station. He's getting paid $1 an hour. Safe to say he's making some more presidents right now. A lot more money in his pockets these days. 2nd and 11. Complete on the skinny slant pattern to Napoleon Outlaw. And it's a first down at the 39-yard line. Tyrone Williams making the tackle. Outlaws look good on the couple of catches he's made today.
Yeah, nice little combination route by the slot receivers. The inside receiver broke to the outside. Outlaw came in on the little slant, and a nice job just confusing the defense, and Banks making the nice throw.
Pretty good numbers for Tony Banks so far. Nebraska showing blitz, and they do come. Banks looking downfield, incomplete for Carter. And once again, Tony Banks getting off the carpet. Came with a dog that time, a blitz, a linebacker blitz. Jay Foreman put him on his wallet.
The good thing that Banks is doing is he's seeing the blitz very early. He's recognizing it. He knows that it's coming at him. And right here, it's going to come from right here. So it's right in the face of Tony Banks. He sees the blitz coming, and he knows he has to throw off that guy. He doesn't have anybody to block him. Takes a chance by throwing it downfield. So the good thing Banks is doing, he's reading the blitz. He's not getting fooled when Nebraska tries to come after him.
He has really continued to improve coming out of junior college a year ago. Last year, he was very much like a freshman, trying to learn the nuances of this offense. Another blitz. They find the hot receiver, the tight end, Bensi. And Bensi has a first down at the 17-yard line for the Spartans. Tackle made by Veland, but not before Bensi picked up 21 yards. Good recognition again by Banks.
Yeah, real good recognition. This is a well-conceived play. Take a look as they come on the blitz again. Eric Warfield, the safety, coming on a safety blitz, almost got a hand on that football, but a good read by Tony Banks hitting his tight end, Bensi.
3 wide receivers in for Michigan State. Nebraska pointing at the left side, pardon me, the right side of the Spartan offensive line. They were pointing at Masalem and Flazell Adams. But it's going to be against Nebraska.
Dead ball. Offside. Defense.
Now these two receivers are going to come off to the inside. The tight end Bensi, he'll release to the outside, and the defense is going to get caught in the wash here. The two inside receivers, they'll occupy the defense. You see, 3 white defenders went to the 2 receivers. Nobody went out with the tight end. A big play against the blitz for Tony Banks.
7:36 remaining in the third quarter. 3 wideouts in for Michigan State. They trail 23-7. Outlaw in motion. Banks. Complete to Scott Green, and Green has another Spartan first down. Good offensive execution by the Spartan offense.
Nebraska really making a commitment to come after Michigan State now. They've blitzed about four plays in a row, and each time Michigan State has made them pay for it. Here comes the blitz again, right into the face of Tony Banks. They're going to run a little slip screen to the fullback. You can see Jared Thomas read the blitz, or read the screen, and tried to turn and make a play, but he was a little too late. And this is Scott Green. He is a productive player.
Soft hands. Haul that thing in with one hand. First down and goal for the Spartans. Carter in motion. The draw. Renan. Homie, don't play that. The Huskers read that one and stuffed it at the 8-yard line.
We talked about how Nebraska's defense is now geared towards speed. It's very similar. They really started making the change after they played Miami and Florida State in the Orange Bowl. They were in a streak where they lost several bowl games in a row to Florida teams, and they've streamlined their defense. And what you see is they get blocked initially, but they don't stay blocked very long. They're very quick getting off of blocks and running to the football.
Second and goal. Banks into the end zone. Incomplete for Mason. Kind of got twisted around back there. Trying to find his receiver. Booker providing the coverage for the Cornhuskers. It'll be third down and goal for Tony Banks.
Good pressure again by the Nebraska defense. I think Banks had to throw that ball a little bit earlier than he wanted to. Really wasn't able to put it in the right spot.
Third down. And goal. A score of some sort is paramount for the Spartans. Banks into the end zone, almost picked off. Whew. Mike Minter was thinking about the pick six lottery and going the other way for a score. I mean, he had nothing but artificial turf ahead of him.
Nebraska kind of baited Banks that time. You see these guys in here, they're showing blitz, but the safety's going to drop into zone coverage. They show blitz, then they come running out of it. It looks like man-to-man coverage, but it's not. Minter is sitting right in the hole to make the good defensive play.
Lucky that they didn't get picked that time. Chris Gardner now in for the field goal from 25 yards out. He's out of Plantation, Florida, 14 of 21 a year ago. Low snap, but it's down, and it's good. A good job that time getting it up. It wasn't pretty, but Solani got it down and up. And Dean Blevins here in East Lansing, Michigan, and another look at that last hold on the field goal attempt.
Yeah, watch Chris Solani. Good job finding the football, getting the laces turned around. I tell you what, you got to have good hands and you've got to have poise to be in that situation, because you're going to get some bad snaps. Nice job by Chris Solani getting it set down for his kicker.
And here's the kick. Ball and Childs fighting over it. Childs takes it and he is brought down on the carpet. Michigan State says they have it, but we'll wait for a signal.
The referee signaled that the ball was down, that the player was down before the ball came out. He came in and made the call right away. Still very aggressive, good heads-up play by Michigan State. Take a look from behind. There was some confusion on who should have the ball. A good tackle coming in there, and you can see his knee is down, and then the ball is going to come out. Good tackle by Brian Echols on the kickoff team.
And a chorus of boos raining down on the officiating crew for making that call. Nevertheless, first and 10 for Nebraska at the 21-yard line. This is their second possession of the third quarter. Lawrence Phillips is back in the ballgame. He's the eye back.
Nebraska does a lot of check with me at the line of scrimmage. They line up, they see where the defense is, and try to run at the weakness.
And they test out that leg of Phillips, and he's brought down at the 25-yard line, a gain of about four. He was injured on their last possession. Ike Reese made the tackle, and they retaped that ankle, sent him back in there. Lawrence Phillips, we got a good look at him yesterday during their walk around, and he's got those trapezius muscles that just don't quit. I mean, he is buffed. He's got diesel.
Yeah, he's put together real well. And, you know, the weightlifting program at Nebraska has been well documented. I mean, they're one of the best. Boyd Epley started it several years ago at Nebraska. And their strength and conditioning program has been a model for a lot of teams all over the country.
Michigan State trying to turn the tide here on this special day. Looking for a special play. And here's a special runner, Lawrence Phillips. with a first down at the 40-yard line. I mentioned it was a special day, and at halftime, one of our very own, Dennis Lewin, a senior vice president of production at ABC Sports, was awarded the 1995 Jack Breslin Life Achievement Award. Denny, one of the great production guys in the business, is a three-time letter winner as manager of the hockey team, 1963, 64, and 65. And a closet full of awards and Emmys. Behringer on the play action, going up top for ball, and he's got him open. Oh, baby, what a catch. He's got skills. Reggie Ball, airborne.
It's only a matter of time before Nebraska is going to try to get you in this situation. They run at you, they lull you to sleep, and then they pull play action and throw it deep. Now, Demetrius Martin, he got caught looking back at the quarterback. His eyes were on the quarterback. He hesitated for a second, and that was all that Reggie Ball needed to run by him. Martin tries to get back into the play, but an outstanding catch by Ball, going up and catching the football with his hands, extending the body, catching it with his hands.
Todd, last week he had a 76-yard reception for a touchdown. That was a career long. Here's Makovic with a fullback down to the one-yard line. It amazes me how they just keep you guessing. Fullback option, so many different packages. They go deep on you. They don't throw the ball often, Todd, but when they do, you know, a lot of them go for big gainers.
Right. I mean, their passing game is designed to get big plays. It's not game. It's not designed to nitpick at you and get 5 yards here, 10 yards here. They try to lull you to sleep with their running game, with the option, and then they go play action deep and throw it to a fast guy out on the outside.
There's a look at the play selection we were referring to moments ago. Second and goal. Lawrence Phillips hits the end zone. He knows where it is.
Nebraska touchdown, 1 yard run, number one, Lawrence Phillips.
Cash it. Lawrence Phillips gets paid, as does the Nebraska offense. Another touchdown, and they lead 29-10. Phillips, 19 rushes, 158 yards, and three touchdowns. Heisman numbers? Yeah, I think so. Going for two now. The pitch to Phillips. Struggles to find the handle and is brought down at the 5-yard line. Tyrone Garland stuffing the play. It's 29-10 in East Lansing. Lawrence Phillips scoring a touchdown. Yesterday saw him at practice. He was listening to his Walkman, listening to a little Jodeci, he told me.
Take a look at this graphic. We showed it earlier. The thing that's impressive about Nebraska, 41 out of 51 times, but look at that, 36 touchdowns, 5 field goals. When they get inside the 20, they put it in the end zone. Michigan State's last series, they had a nice drive. They got it inside the 20, had to settle for a field goal. That's the difference.
This one, Todd, coming down at the 2-yard line. Mason has been unable to break one today. The Nebraska special teams on kickoff has been very efficient today.
I'm a firm believer in the fact that if you have an experienced quarterback coming back, you have an advantage in early season games. And Texas Tech, Zevi Lethbridge is a very good quarterback. Penn State starting Wally Richardson has not had much game experience. They've dropped the ball on the carpet a couple times, and Zevi Lethbridge is playing very well for Texas Tech.
All those long trips by Texas Tech Spike Dykes across the Texas Plains really paying off. His recruiting really starting to flourish a little bit down there. 4:25 to play in the third quarter. Banks hands it off. Green reverses field out to the 24-yard line. Gain of about 4 on the play. The tackle made by Ryan Terwilliger.
That's a typical Scott Green play. It doesn't look like much. It doesn't look like he's going to gain any yards. He doesn't look flashy doing what he does. All he does is gain 5 yards. And you move the sticks, and he's just that kind of a productive player.
Look at some of the action in the Big 8 today. Soon to become the Big 12. A lot of evening programs. And don't forget that on ESPN tonight, it's Colorado and Colorado State. Buffalo's looking impressive last week on ABC against Wisconsin. That's Scott Green out to the 26-yard line. You know, when Nick Saban took over this program, one of the biggest problems they faced were players who were not in good condition. Finish that story up a little later, and Dean Blevins has something more for us now.
Well, Nebraska has your typical bumps and bruises, and all players will continue to play with the exception of Frazier, but Michigan State's number 44 linebacker Ike Reese had his hand x-rayed at half, a cracked bone in it, and they put a soft cast on it, and Sean Hart has cramps, the starting cornerback, number 17, he will play.
All right, Dean, 3 minutes to go now. Banks tipped at the line, up in the air. Play a little hot potato. It'll be fourth down and three. Punting time for the Spartans. And in the corner of the end zone, there is a sea of red. The Cornhusker fans responding vocally to that great stand by the Nebraska defense.
Charlie McBride, the defensive coordinator for the Huskers, he is really coming after Tony Banks. Now, until they get inside the 10-yard line, then they're playing zone defense. But out in the field, he feels comfortable with his defense and the lead they have to really come after him.
Terrell Farley, where are you? He's blocked nicely on that play. And the punt will be downed at the 33-yard line. Well, are Joe's boys going to come back in Penn State? John, what's up?
Well, Mark, fumbles causing problems for Penn State, now causing problems for Texas Tech. Byron Hansbard coughs it up here. Terry Killens, the linebacker, recovers it, and it sets up a Penn State touchdown on the next play. John Whitman, with his second of the game, just bowls his way into the end zone, and right now it's 20-14. We'll keep you up to date. Mark.
All right. There is a palpitating Penn State heart next to me, folks. It's getting a little stronger, too. Lawrence Phillips trying the left side and stuffed by Jabbar Threach. And flags down, maybe a little extra, a little too much extra by Threach.
That's really an unfortunate penalty if that's the way it's going to go, because
yeah.
Jabbar Threach played this play so well, and he's had a good game. The junior college transfer out of Garden City Community College in Kansas has stepped in and played very well in
his
first game.
Personal foul, defense, first down.
Boy, I'm with you on that, Todd. I mean, you can't fault the officials, but it's tough to turn it off.
Well, watch the play now. You know, Jabbar Threach has made a great play right there. Okay, the play is stopped. And I think they're calling, you know, a late play at the end of the play. Terry Harvey, number 51, came running in there and got a shot towards the end of the play. I don't think the penalty was on Threach. I think it was called by someone coming late and making a hit on the play.
It might have been that little body slam at the end. 2.5 to play in the third quarter. Handoff is to the fullback, Makavica. You know, moments ago, I was talking about Coach Saban and the type of program that he inherited. One of the most important things that he had to rectify was the conditioning and strength of the players. That is where his strength and conditioning coach, Ken Manny, came into play. He has made certain foods and places around campus off limits to up their muscle tone and lower the body fat percentage. And as a result, chicken wings at the Land Shark on Monday nights are now a faux pas. Stuffed at the 49-yard line by Ike Reese.
Ike Reese, you can see he's got the cast on his hand. He had the broken bone in his hand, and he's a competitor. I mean, you know, he's a perfect guy to play for this team because their nickname is the Spartan. You talk about a Spartan football player. Ike Reese is a Spartan. He loves to compete. He loves to fight. Watch, good defense, good penetration, and leverage by Ike Reese. Keeping outside position, forcing Lawrence Phillips back to the inside.
Reese, one of those players that came in improved condition. Was talking about how they have a better diet this year in East Lansing. Their food is color-coded, Todd. Green is recommended for everyone. Yellow is okay food with limitations, and red is off-limits for guys trying to lose weight. All right, Monday night. It's the Packers and the Bears live at 9 Eastern time in the Windy City, one of the oldest rivalries in the NFL, old black and blue football. Brett Favre at the helm for Green Bay. And the former Heisman Trophy winner, Rashawn Salaam. Get a good look at him for the Chicago Bears.
Chicago looked very good in their opener last week. Eric Kramer played well, back as the starting quarterback for the Bears. And look at the quarterbacks in this ball game. Brett Behringer in there a lot today now. 4 of 7, had the big pass to Reggie Ball. Tony Banks, pretty decent numbers, but you know, now they're in a situation where he's got to make some big plays. And in fairness to him, it's pretty tough when you're behind against a good defense and you can't run the football. But he's got to get some plays downfield to his wide receivers and try to get some quick points on the board.
Behringer, active hunter, and Fisher. And word coming now that it's official. Deion Sanders is now a member of the Dallas Cowboys, signing a reported 5-year deal. Don't know the numbers on it yet, but Troy Aikman did restructure his contract and give up $2 million. They might have to put Deion on layaway, the amount of money they're paying him. The snap goes to Phillips. They got all kinds of tricks. And these tricks aren't for kids, because Phillips is going to score. Touchdown, Cornhuskers. The snap went right to Phillips, and he went right to the end zone in the express lane.
They've been in this formation 2 times. Now, this is Phillips right here. The center's just going to snap the ball right to him. Behringer will act like he gets the ball and going to pass. Everybody's looking at Behringer. Nobody sees that Phillips has the ball. They've been in that formation 2 times. One time they ran the option for a big play. This time they direct snap it to Phillips, and it's a touchdown. One more big play by Nebraska. You've got to be prepared that they're going to try to get big plays on you, and if they get more than a few, it can be a long day for your defense.
And Coach Saban talked about assignments, and Coach Pease also talked about assignments on the option, but just like you said earlier, Todd, how do you prepare for all these different things? I mean, I'm not sure that the Spartans were thinking about the direct snap play to Lawrence Phillips that time.
Well, in Nebraska, you know, in years past, when Nebraska had great football teams, they never lined up in 4 wide receivers. They never lined up in the shotgun. You could pretty much narrow down what they were going to try to do to you offensively. But the real change that Tom Osborne has brought to this offense is they give you 5 or 6 different formations. They run their option out of all those formations. So if you're a defensive coach and you're preparing during the week, you've got to show your team, okay, when they get in this set, they've got 3 wide receivers. Now this set, they have 2 tight ends and 1 back. This set, you know, and you've got to prepare to stop the option and stop all the things they do in every formation. And Tom Osborne has done a great job changing his philosophy of how to call plays and using more personnel and different formations.
Osborne extremely pleased, no doubt, with those 206 yards on the ground by Phillips today. Todd, I want to ask you, do you think that it's going to hurt Frazier and Phillips in terms of splitting votes for the Heisman Trophy?
I think ultimately that will hurt them. I think that it's tough to have 2 Heisman candidates on the same football team. And certainly Lawrence Phillips, though, is 153 yards in the opener last week, over 200 yards in this game. He's making a very strong statement. And unfortunate for Tommy Frazier, being on the bench, it's pretty hard to impress anybody.
And Brooke Behringer with his pilot's license, piloting this team to a very successful second half so far. Dean Blevins has more from a QB's perspective.
Well, I say you vote for the quarterback all the time, guys. I'm sure Todd agrees.
Oh, I'm shocked.
You know, most schools overhype their candidates, but Nebraska does have that position where they have 2 of them. We talked to the SID office before the game about choosing one over the other. They said, no, they aren't going to do that because the Huskers are on TV so much, the voters can virtually see them every week, and they know what they can do.
Yeah, Tommy Frazier can do a lot. The fifth born of Priscilla and Tommy Frazier Sr. 9 pounds and 6 ounces at birth, and he has since matured into a very fine quarterback and Heisman Trophy candidate at 210 pounds.
Touchback.
Chris Brown kicks it out of the end zone.
First down, Michigan State at the 20.
It's been a good day for the freshman place kicker, too. 3 field goals, a few extra points. Made history last week against Oklahoma State, being one of the few freshmen ever to start for Tom Osborne as a place kicker. 1:10 to play in the third quarter. Nebraska in control. Antoine Patrick in motion. On the screen. Green has some good blocks ahead of him. And that's why I like Scotty Green.
You don't see him run out of bounds. He'll put that shoulder on you and put the hat on you, too. Fighting for every single yard. Ryan Terwilliger making the tackle along with Mike Minter. And don't forget, coming up next, Lou Holtz and the Fighting Irish trying to bounce back from that loss last week, taking on their in-state rivals from Purdue.
Michigan State has had some pretty good success running the screens today. Now, they haven't had much success running the football, but when you run the screen, it's the same effect. You take advantage of an aggressive defense that's trying to rush the passer, let them come upfield, throw the screen over their head.
That one's working out well. Banks fumbles it. Did he get it back? Yes, he did. And now a little extracurricular activity. That's Flozell Adams, number 76.
Well, Flozell was venting a little frustration because he got beat by Jared Tomish on the play. Top left of your screen is where the pressure's going to come from. Tomish ran right around Flozell Adams, made the sack, caused the fumble, and then Flozell was just trying to pull Tomish off of his quarterback. Watch again, coming from the right of your screen, Tomish with the arm sweep, knocks the ball loose, and there's Flozell just saying, okay, you beat me, you made me look bad, but just get off my quarterback.
25 seconds to play in the third.
Yes!
Under pressure again. Well, Tony, Mama said there'd be days like this. Terrell Farley, the junior college sack specialist and special teams man, making the tackle. Assisted by Warfield. And that ends the third quarter of play in East Lansing in game one of the Nick Saban era. It's not the way he planned it. We'll return with more between Nebraska and Michigan State after this message. The word from our ABC station. Back at Spartan Stadium, I'm Mark Jones, along with Todd Blackledge and Dean Blevins on the field. 36-10 as we begin the fourth quarter of play. The defending national champs from Nebraska with an impressive performance today. Brooke Behringer coming in relief of injured quarterback Tommy Frazier. And Tony Banks has been running for his life all day. Mason with the catch at the 33-yard line, complete. But it's short of the first down, and they'll have to punt. And now Mason comes up limping.
Pretty good idea by Gary Tranquil, the offensive coordinator. They've been getting after your quarterback on the blitz. Move him to a different spot. Get him out of the pocket a little bit. Nice effort by Banks to elude the rush, the safety coming on the blitz, and makes the nice throw back to the middle of the field, but short of the first down.
He can improvise. Chris Solani into punt from his 25, and back deep, it's Reggie Ball. This one taking a Cornhusker bounce back to the 33-yard line. Time for us to call a timeout. We'll be right back.
I wonder if that John Madden has his own bus. You think?
Hey, Dean, ask them if they can hook me up with a little boys to men after this, will you, please? They are one of the better ones in the Big Ten Conference. Amon Green now in a tailback. And you talk about a skilled and speedy runner. He is all that. A thriller heating up in Penn State. John Saunders has more on that. John?
Mark, indeed. Fourth down and one, and they decide to go to the pass. Wally Richardson, though, hits Keith Olsemer from 3 yards out, and Penn State has taken the lead 21-20. Mark?
Todd, would Joe let you throw a pass like that?
I don't know.
Gutsy call.
Yeah, good call.
Somebody broke off a pattern. Brendan Holbein ran a post, and Behringer threw it to the flag. So they'll talk that one over and hopefully get it straightened out for their sake. And it will be third down and one to go.
See, talk about consistency with Nebraska's football program. They just, you know, Tom Osborne is his 23rd year. They've been winning 9-10 games every year. Great consistency. Just, you know, he's had assistants that have been there 15, 16, 20 years, and they just
They just keep coming at you. I mean, that's the trademark of this football team is they just are relentless, and they win games in the fourth quarter by wearing you down.
And Amon Green is on his way. He says, see ya, and I wouldn't want to be ya. Touchdown, Cornhuskers. A 57-yard bolt of lightning on a sunny afternoon in East Lansing. Amon Green scores a touchdown. Amon Green is listed as the number four tailback, but they have high hopes for him. Heavily recruited out of high school, out of Omaha, Nebraska, played at Central High School. Great speed. They said he broke all their testing records for freshmen coming in. He's got a bright future, and they say he runs a lot like Lawrence Phillips. So that's bad news for Big 8 or Big 12 foes in the next couple years.
Chris Brown with the extra point. His leg might be getting a little fatigued right now. He nails it through, and it is 43-10. But the band plays on for the Spartans. This day has belonged to the Big Red. 13:24 remaining in the fourth quarter, and Nebraska leads Michigan State 43-10. I'm Mark Jones, along with Todd Blackledge and Dean Blevins. Dirk Mason kind of set the tone early for Michigan State on that fumbled kickoff return in the first quarter. Corrals this one at the goal line.
Rocked at the 20. Wow.
What a hit.
Aaron Penland, a backup linebacker, came in there with a big hit on special teams. You talk about consistency. Look at Nebraska. 180 consecutive games they've won when they score 35 points or more. Overall, 245-1. Interestingly, the only loss was to Oklahoma, 49-35 back in 1950. I think Dean was a quarterback on that team. I'm not sure. We'll have to check with him.
No, it wasn't that year.
Well, we're still debating over that alleged 4-5-5-40 that he says he ran back then, too.
Hey, the bad thing for Nebraska fans is that that used to outrun some of their defenses. But now that's the difference, guys. That's this team has remarkable defensive speed, and that's what's gotten them over the edge.
Yeah, you're so right, Dean. That's Derek Mason, the injured Spartan player, favoring his right leg. Another look at the injury.
Well, Mason has had the one fumble earlier in the ball game and really gets good lick that time by Aaron Penland. I think it looked like he was just cramping up coming off the field, but Mason, a top returning kickoff returner in the Big Ten, had a 100-yard return against Penn State in the season finale last year.
Banks out of the shotgun. The screen to Scotty Green.
Go, baby, go, go, baby, go.
Oh, yeah. Scotty Green finally run down at the 22-yard line by Tony Veland. Green moving all of those 227 pounds downfield, showing a good burst of acceleration.
Well, Gary Tranquil said he didn't think this guy was very fast. He showed some jets there going down the sideline. Again, the screen play has been very effective against that good pass rush of Nebraska. And Scotty Green, when he got on the sideline, picked up a good block from his center, Matt Beard. Showed a lot of speed running down the sideline before he's caught by the free safety, Tony Veland. We know Veland, he's a sprinter. He's a 4-5 guy, so Green showed good speed.
Banks brought down and sacked at the 32-yard line. Christian Peter says hello. Last week, the Nebraska Blackshirt defense had 5 sacks, and they add to their season total on that play. It'll be second down from the 30. Hurry up offense. Banks into the end zone. Incomplete, intended for Napoleon Outlaw. Veland again on the coverage. Florida State leading Clemson. And Michigan up 3 touchdowns. Now, I'm really excited about the program under Schnellenberger at Oklahoma. I think he's going to do some real great things.
He's done a great job everywhere he's gone. Every program that he's gone to, he has made him a winner. So I'm sure they'll be anxious to see that happen out in Norman.
Banks complete. And Mike Minter introduced himself to Luke Bensi. Mike Minter. Banks with another completion. More action in the Big Ten today. Penn State with a one-point lead over Texas Tech in the fourth quarter now. And don't forget, coming up next, Purdue and Notre Dame from West Lafayette, Indiana. Game you'll see right here on ABC, beginning at 3:30 Eastern time. Banks. Boy, he lowered his hat and was met by Farley and Minter. That's why they call him Baby Randall. He has the ability to scramble. Right now, we'd like to pause 5 seconds to allow our stations to identify themselves. Score in East Lansing, Michigan, Nebraska 43, Michigan State 10, with 11:54 remaining in the fourth quarter. Brooke Behringer has gone most of the way for the injured Tommy Frazier. Frazier, starting quarterback, shaken up with a deep thigh bruise in the first half. Clinton Childs is the lone back, and Behringer is going to throw. Complete to his tight end, Gilman. And Gilman is gang tackled at the 25. Gilman last week with 3 catches for a total of 31 yards. He's brought down by Shirelles and Reese.
People might be wondering now, well, why is Tom Osborne calling pass plays for Brooke Behringer at this point, winning 43-10 in the fourth quarter? Brooke Behringer may have to start the game next week. Tommy Frazier still may not be back from that thigh bruise. You don't know how quickly he's going to heal through the week. And so you want to get Behringer some work throwing the football. They don't need to throw right now in order to win the football game, but they've got to give him a little opportunity to run the offense and get his feet wet throwing the football.
Always an asset when you have 2 starting quarterbacks in your lineup. That was Childs, brought down by Marvin Wright. Don't forget, next Saturday, 3:30 Eastern, 2:30 Central, a slate of college football here on ABC, Washington, Ohio State, Colorado State Air Force. We'll be out in Pasadena doing the Bruins and the Ducks, Pittsburgh and Texas, and Tennessee taking on the fun and gun offense in Florida. A game in Tennessee. That's at 3:30 Eastern, 2:30 Central. Call your cable operator for the pay-per-view games available in your area. Lawrence Phillips out of West Covina, California. The Cornhuskers presently awaiting an investigation, an ongoing investigation by the NCAA into some money and a car provided by the group home of which Phillips is a member. But he has been cleared to play. Thus, there will be no forfeiture of games by the Cornhuskers.
You got to really respect Lawrence Phillips, too, because he's been able to put that beside him and go out and play. And take a look at this again. We talked about how well they play when they score 35 points, when they rush for over 300 yards, or 139, 5-0.
Little counter tray right here. Clinton Childs finding a gaping hole. Looked like there might have been a face mask, but no flag thrown at the 47-yard line. Robert Shirelles again making another tackle. And as I said earlier, a bad sign, Todd, when your safeties are making a lot of stops.
Yeah, it sounds good on the stat sheet, but you don't like it when your safeties are coming up. Take a look at today, 450 yards rushing for Nebraska. They ran for 513 last week against Oklahoma State. It really isn't any wonder why Nebraska has led the nation in rushing 3 of the last 4 seasons. I mean, they keep grinding at you. They got big bodies up front. They keep pushing you, and they wear you down with great tailbacks.
In the flat, Clinton Childs unable to hang on to that one.
Third pass incomplete, headed for Childs. And him.
Tommy Frazier, you know, interesting about Tommy, he has a brother, Rod, who's 17 years old and is at the moment a major college prospect at Manatee High School back in Bradenton, Florida.
Yeah, I think he's a running back, ran for over 100 yards in his opening game as a high school player.
Behringer back to pass on 2nd and 10. The flanker screen to Holbein. Holbein is tackled at the 47-yard line. He'll be about 4 yards short of the first down. If time permits, stay tuned, folks, for the Thrifty Car Rental post-game report featuring scores and highlights from across the country. A tackle made by Chris Smith on that last play. When you look at the advantage enjoyed by Nebraska right now. You think about the margin of victory eventually and how that can influence the voters in the poll. You don't like to see people run it up, but it's tough to tell kids out there not to play hard. The give is to the fullback.
Yeah, I don't have a problem with your kids playing hard. I'm not sure that you should keep your starters in late in ball games. Get your other guys in the ball game and let them play hard. And if they score, well, then shame on the defense for not finishing out the game and really playing to the best of their abilities. But I'll tell you what, I think Nebraska under Tom Osborne, they won the national championship last year. I think they should be the number one ranked team in the country. Most people say Florida State, but Nebraska still hasn't been beaten. I mean, they were the best team in the country last year, and they have not dropped off much this year. Even though they lost 14 starters off of that team, I still think they're the best team in the country.
And their schedule is very conducive to finishing undefeated again. The ball taking a Michigan State bounce that time, coming all the way out to the 15-yard line, where it's finally down. Michigan State looking to salvage a little more than pride with 9:03 to play. Welcome back, everyone, to East Lansing, Michigan. Todd, we talked about Nebraska and their upcoming schedule. Very conducive to going undefeated, even before they're tested in a strong way by Colorado.
Yeah, it really was. You know, they've had two road games to start the season, which was a little unusual, but now they go home. They get five games in a row at home. Not a real stiff challenge in those five games. October 28th, I think, is when they get Colorado. That'll be their stiffest challenge. They should be undefeated by that point in the season.
And they have had a ton of success against the Buffaloes of late. Last year, they really waxed them. Bit of a surprise, too, in very convincing fashion. The guy who's very familiar with Nebraska, having played against them, is Dean Blevins. Dean?
Guys, it's really ironic that the Michigan State man is largely responsible for Nebraska's turnaround. The late Duffy Doherty offered Bob Devaney a job at a time that Devaney had planned to quit as a football coach and to go into business. And there's Bob, a wonderful man. He is the athletic director emeritus at Nebraska now. And the rest of Nebraska football history is history, actually. Back-to-back titles in 70 and 71.
Tremendous, almost unparalleled football tradition in Nebraska. Here's Banks. Backside pressure, and he throws it away. Good coverage that time on Scott Green by Terrell Farley.
You know, and when we talked to Nick Saban, and he made reference to Nebraska, and he talked about the consistency of the program, the established nature of their program, it's all handed down from Devaney and then to Tom Osborne. They've had great continuity in their program. Their assistant coaches stay there a long time. And when kids sign up to go there to school, they know, hey, this system and this coaching staff is going to be in place for a long time. There's great continuity, great stability there, and that means a lot to high school players looking for a place to call home for 4 years.
And Nick Saban is hoping that many players across the country will choose to call East Lansing home in the future. Did a decent job of recruiting, although he came in kind of late.
Well, Tony Banks has had a tough go here in the second half because they've had to play catch-up. Nebraska has played their nickel and dime defense the entire second half and really blitzed them and hit them and bounced them around today. But he's going to be a good football player, a good quarterback in the Big Ten this year. He just went up against an awful good Nebraska defense.
Suffice to say that, Todd, they might not be tested this much at all in the remainder of the season. Chris Solani kicks it through the end zone. Todd, let's check back with some of our storylines after that 83-yard punt.
We can see Nebraska, they protected the football, only one turnover. They were able to put great pressure on Tony Banks, particularly in the second half. Seven hurries, and they hit him several other times. Banks, pretty good numbers throwing the football, but had to play catch-up. They didn't do a great job on first down. Michigan State didn't do a great job defensively on first down. And the big plays, Lawrence Phillips responsible for the majority of big plays against the Spartans today.
And now we have the third string quarterback in, Matt Turman, who hands it off to James Sims. Sims says goodbye, Spartans. Now, if that's the fourth string guy, I don't want to see the fifth string guy, Todd. They just keep coming and coming and coming.
Well, he is the fourth string tailback, but he is the fastest player on the Nebraska football team. When they timed everybody last spring, 4.41 speed in the 40-yard dash. And once he got through the secondary, you've got a tired Michigan State defense on the field. And James Sims, is he was off to the races.
Boy, they really miss Damon Benning today, don't they?
Damon Benning might be wanting to look up in his history book who Wally Pipp was.
Yep. Don't get hurt or miss many games because you never know. 50-10. Lots of talent in the cupboard in Lincoln. Let me see. I thought John said $12 million. $12 million signing bonus, and Deion Sanders, one of the premier players when he's playing football, able to change the complexion and the balance of power pretty much too, defensively and offensively time.
Well, he wants to play offense, but I mean, his great value is he can lock up on a receiver and just take him out of the football game. As you take a look at the updated score, Texas Tech again on top of Penn State, but Deion Sanders, I mean, you can put him out there on a guy man-to-man and just leave him alone and then kind of gear the rest of your defense to helping somebody else that might need help or blitzing the quarterback, and that's why everybody wanted him.
With the salary cap restrictions, it's important to become very creative when you do contracts. Mark Renaud on the return that time out to the 27-yard line. And as was reported earlier, Troy Aikman reportedly, do I say gave up $2 million? Deferred $2 million to fit Deion into the salary structure.
I think what Nick Saban wants to see right now is that his team for the last 8 minutes and 18 seconds of this game, just play hard. You continue to play hard. You're down 50-10. This is one of the best, if not the best team in the country. And you're starting a new system here, a new program, and you want to build some character in your football team. You want to see them play hard for the full 60 minutes.
Yeah, that is the Nick Saban way.
That's it.
Nice stick that time. The linebackers filling nicely. Don't forget, coming up next, Notre Dame Purdue from West Lafayette, Indiana. Purdue taking, hopefully for them, another step towards respectability in the Big Ten. Trying to move up among the upper tier teams in the conference. There's a look at one of the upper tier coaches in college football, Tom Osborne. 7:40 to play. Banks, play action. Complete to Mason at the 39-yard line and stuck by number 12, Mike Fullman, the backup cornerback.
First down, Michigan State.
It's good to see Mason back in the ball game. Didn't return that last kickoff. Good timing route, the slant pattern. Little high, but Mason does a nice job knowing he's going to get hit, but making the catch. Good tackle by Fullman, a transfer from Rutgers. Fullman is the smallest guy on the team. We know they've got a lot of big guys, but Fullman is the smallest guy, 5'7", 160 pounds.
That's out of the eye. The give is to Patrick, and Patrick is tackled at the 39-yard line, right at the line of scrimmage. Memphis finally getting on the board against Michigan. The Sooners still have a lot of talent. I was referring to that earlier. And coming up next, Purdue and Notre Dame. .6:40 to play. Banks is going to pass. Throws a nice out pattern, complete. Near midfield at the 49-yard line.
Octavius
Long making the reception.
People ask, you know, what's a big league arm? What's an NFL-style arm? This is it right here. He was on the left hash. He's throwing a 15-yard out to the right sideline, and it's on a rope. There was no air under that ball. I mean, that is a big league arm by Tony Banks. He comes out of the break, and the ball is waiting for him on the sideline. Very few quarterbacks in college football can drop back and make that throw on a consistent basis.
With that great size, too. They hand it off to Scotty Green. Brought down at the 46-yard line this time. A tackle made by John Hesse. And we will see Michigan State play hard the entire 60 minutes. That is the Nick Saban way. He describes his philosophy as confront and demand, and he's a very demanding coach. When he first got the job here, had a team meeting, called all the players in and said it was going to be his way, or, well, there's the door, basically, and nobody left. They've made a commitment, and you got the feeling that the players here in East Lansing wanted to be disciplined. Brought down by Farley. Terrell Farley sacks Tony Banks back at the 46-yard line.
Tough to run that bootleg into the face of a blitz. That time, if you drop back and pass, it's a little easier because you can see it coming. Take a look at Michigan State's schedule. Of course, you see they only have the one bye week listed there, November 18th, because they didn't start last week. They had the first weekend off. This is their opener.
They play Boston College on the 30th. That's going to be a real nice game. Mark Hartzell, the quarterback for Boston College, extremely talented. They got a win on Thursday night.
Yeah, that was a tough win. Going to Blacksburg and win, that's a good bounce-back victory for Boston College.
50-10. And Tony Banks is on the move. Oh, wow, did he get jammed up at the 35-yard line. And the ball is loose downfield. I'm telling you, when Tony Banks comes to, his clothes are going to be out of style. That was a heck of a hit. It's nice to see him up.
Well, Banks just held on to this ball for so long, and the defense, as he left the pocket, he's got white shirts following him. Now, this is not a fumble. He was throwing the football forward, but Chad Kelsey came in there and really put a lick on him.
Is that what you call it? Oh, wow.
I mean, you know, you're so unprotected in that kind of a situation. You just can't, you know, you got to know that that defensive is coming after you. You've got to get rid of the football.
Yeah, Banks looking for the team chiropractor right now. Under 5 minutes to play. Solani with a nice punt, driving ball back to the 7-yard line. Number 7 is going to try and return it. Good special teams coverage that time. Number 35, Brian Echols, making the stick. A 47-yard punt, middle on the return.
Go, go!
I'm surrounded by quarterbacks. Right, Dean Plevins?
Hey, that's right. And we're going to get on our big friend in the booth there, Todd Blackledge. 1982 to set the scene. Happy Valley, Nebraska taking on Penn State. Both teams undefeated. 13 seconds to go. Todd Blackledge back. He finds Mike McCloskey inbounds or out. Nebraska fans still saying out. Take a look at it. McCloskey.
Ooh. He got a big foot.
I don't know. All right. And there were a couple of other calls that were questionable. We'll hear Todd's side in a minute. Now, the counterpart to Todd is on the other side today. Nebraska quarterback Turner Gill. And he is the quarterback's coach here. Turner, good friend of yours, I guess, Todd. But he said definitely bad call. What do you say, big guy?
Oh, he was standing so far away. How could he see?
Joe Paterno eventually said it was a bad call. What do you say to that? You guys did go on to win the title, and congratulations to you. But Nebraska looking for two in a row now. They've done okay without it.
I'll tell you what, we played, had a great series with Nebraska. And, yeah, that it was a very questionable call. They're late in the ball game, but it was a great game. And we had a couple great battles. And Turner Gill was an outstanding quarterback for Nebraska. I really enjoyed it.
You know, I know you and Coach Paterno have a great relationship. Some people may not know Tom Osborne was a groomsman in Turner Gill's way.
Hey, Dean, by the way, I'm with you. I think he was out of bounds, just for the record. Well, the genuine Chevrolet most valuable players of the game are Lawrence Phillips from Nebraska with 206 yards rushing, 4 touchdowns, and Tony Banks from Michigan State, 21 to 35 for 290 yards, a touchdown, and an interception. In celebrating its 25th year of NCAA sponsorship, Chevrolet will donate $1,000 to each school's general scholarship fund to reward outstanding students for their academic achievements and to assist those in financial need. Terman passing, broken up nicely. That was Aldi Henry.
You know, the worst thing about showing that play
is
now I've got to answer questions about
come
that.
Come correct every and time come
I,
clean.
Every time I talk to anybody from Nebraska again.
Let me change the subject for us. A quick second here. Nebraska at home, as we mentioned, for the next five consecutive games before the big one against Colorado. And then, speaking of big ones, a game you'll see on ABC November the 24th against Oklahoma. Last year, the Sooners played them tough before the Cornhuskers finally prevailed. That's Terman on the option, keeping it out to the 26-yard line, where he's tackled by Tyrone Garland. As you were saying, my man.
You know, one of the things about Nebraska is the continuity we talked about in the program. Look at this. Combined 114 years of experience in the assistant coaches. That's Turner Gill there. Now, he's only been there 4 years, but he was a player for Tom Osborne in the system. Everybody that's been there is very familiar with the system. And defensive coordinator Charlie McBride's been there 19 years. Frank Solich, the assistant head coach, has been there 17 years. I mean, it's just great stability in that Nebraska football program.
As you mentioned, that really is a positive when you're recruiting. And their counterparts, the crew that Nick Saban has assembled, also with a very impressive resume.
Yeah, Nick Saban really feels like he's put a great staff together. Now, two of the coaches on the staff, Pat Shermer, the tight end coach, and Bobby Williams, the running back coach, they were holdovers from the old staff. Everyone else he brought in new. Charlie Baggett was a former quarterback here at Michigan State. Last year was with the Oilers. The defensive coordinator, Dean Pease, he was at Notre Dame last year. So he's put together a very good staff as well.
Now, Gary Tranquil really did some innovative things at Virginia Tech. Turned that thing around. Push punting. Mason at the 27. Little stop and go, and then stopped at the 28-yard line. With 2:09 to play. And don't forget, coming up next is the Notre Dame Fighting Irish against Purdue. So stay tuned for that one.
Now, you mentioned Gary Tranquil. It's interesting. This is the fourth time that Tranquil and Saban have been together. I mean, they've been together at a couple different places. In fact, at one point in their careers, Gary Tranquil was the head coach at Navy, and Saban was one of his assistants. They were together with the Cleveland Browns for about 3 years in 91 through 94. So these guys are very familiar with each other and have a good relationship.
And speaking of offense, get a look at the new quarterback, Damian Hyram. He's a 6'5" sophomore, 198 pounds. A couple of tall quarterbacks for the Spartans. Banks also going 6'5". And then behind Hyram, they have Gus Ornstein, a transfer from Notre Dame, who the coaching staff is very high on.
Well, that's a shocker there. North Carolina off to an 0-2 start. Mac Brown's team was expected to make a run for something in the ACC.
This is Tyrone Crenshaw. The deep back, who gets the carry out to the 35-yard line. 1:25 to play. Look once again at the quarterback in the game now, Hyram. From Jackson, Michigan.
Didn't have any game action last year. Played pretty well during the spring. Moved himself into that number two spot. There's Tony Banks again. He'll have better games this season. And he's a talented quarterback. Really has a chance to play in the NFL also if he puts together another solid season this year.
Yeah, like getting a slow start today. Nice run out to the 4-6 yard line. That was Crenshaw again. But getting back to Banks, last year he got off to a rather slow start and then finished the season very strongly and brought the team to a respectable 5-6 record, but they have had four consecutive losing seasons here in East Lansing.
In fairness to Tony Banks, too, now he came from junior college, which is a big adjustment anyway, and his second year here, and he's had to learn a whole new offensive system. So he's had to learn two new systems in as many seasons here as a Spartan.
Hyram on the run. Tried to move him out of the pocket, but it broke down at the 46-yard line where he's tackled. With 20 seconds to play. The day has belonged to the Big Red from Lincoln, Nebraska. The defending national champions going to win this one 50-10. Another very convincing Nebraska victory. As they improve to 2-0 on the season.
Four,
And as he's done so many times during his tenure, Tom Osborne running across the field, victorious. And coming up next, don't forget Notre Dame and Purdue right here on ABC. The final score once again, 50-10 for Dean Blevins and Todd Blackledge. I'm Mark Jones. It's all good. We'll see you next week.